Penn Jillette outside the studio. And Roland just handed us ice cream.
Yeah, I normally wouldn't eat ice cream this early in the morning, but I'm going to have a couple of bites.
Penn.
How you doing,
my friend?
Good to see some friendly
faces. Absolutely.
What's up, Penn?
Oh, I'm going to try out some of this ice cream here.
The ice cream looks all right, brother.
It's really good.
Look at the packaging. My God.
Oh, my God.
Will this actually be in stores?
What do you mean, will it be? It's in stores now.
Oh, sorry.
And, you know, we've already bought several cartons. That's what we're supposed to say.
This is so creamy and
it's
delicious.
Creamy and good, and it's mine.
Oh, look at the chocolate in here. Oh, my God.
I'll have a couple of bites. I've been on a good diet, but I have to try it.
It would be impolite.
Oh, my God.
Ice cream is so good.
I'm going to have such gassers on the plane today, too, because lactose does that to me.
Yeah.
That's my main motivation of trying some ice cream.
Oh, no, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Jimmy goes, yeah.
What's the story behind the ice cream there?
Well, you know, I'm on this television program called Celebrity Apprentice.
Yes, we do know that.
And the final task, and I'm a finalist,
mm-hmm.
you know? And last time I was here, I was already a finalist, but I kept it from you.
I know you did.
I kept it from you.
We tried to get it out of you, too.
I know. But I was a finalist. But you knew in your heart.
Yeah, we did.
You're like Nixon. You know in your heart he's right. How good is the ice cream?
Oh my God.
So we had a design for Walgreens, or as it is in New York, Dwayne Reed.
Uh-huh.
We had a design and ice cream. And Trace went with carpet fibers and shit as his flavor. And I went with this rich vanilla ice cream with sea salt chocolate and fudge caramel candy pieces.
So it's all about the sea salt, sir.
This is amazing.
Yes, it is, and that's my idea.
Sea salt is taking over the world.
You know what?
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
You just won.
Right,
when you said that.
I think I did, yeah.
Right when you said that, I got a taste of the chocolate with the sea salt.
Yeah.
Who would think that would be good with ice cream? It is.
Penn Jillette.
Exactly.
Celebrity Apprentice. That's the answer.
You're also a magician with ice cream, my friend.
And it's $100,000 to whoever sells the most ice cream to our charities.
I thought per carton.
Yeah. and it would be a bargain at that, wouldn't it?
Wait, I got to ask one question before I endorse your ice cream.
Yeah.
Does the other guy have peanut butter in his ice cream?
No.
Oh,
okay.
Okay.
I'm all in.
He has macadamia maple.
Oh, really?
No, that's terrible.
That's a good reaction. That isn't.
This is all American.
When I said carpet fibers and shit, you went, yeah. When I say macadamia and maple, no.
Ew.
You know, and my charity is a charity, Opportunity Village in Vegas. It's kind of a David and Goliath thing because
mm-hmm.
he's got. Yeah, I was hoping he would go for American Nazi Party,
right.
But instead he went for Red Cross,
which
is a fine charity. But you know, $100,000 to a local charity in Vegas that helps people with intellectual disabilities get jobs, is huge. You know, $100,000 to the Red Cross, it's like, fuck you, $100,000.
Yeah, we
got that up our ass. So, you know, I'm hoping. And I've been eating this ice cream, you know, because I go on shows.
Yeah.
You know, and I eat the ice cream for show, but I still end up eating it. I love it.
It's so good.
And I mean this very sincerely. That might be the best ice cream I've ever eaten.
So
I'm not being polite because you're here.
Good.
Well, thank you.
That is fucking amazing.
Did you actually come up with this?
Yes, you're that's the nutty thing about Celebrity Apprentice.
I don't know what's real with that shit.
Well, no, some of the... Most of Celebrity Apprentice is just real. They don't read stuff behind the camera. They don't do retakes. All that stuff I've done in every other show, they don't do.
Is there a way to bet on the winner? Because you got this. You got this.
Okay, well, good. You know, I hope so.
Hold on. I had a second question. So you came up with this, right?
Yeah.
It's an amazing flavor. Jimmy's saying it's the best ice cream he ever ate.
I really mean it.
I can't stop.
Does freaking Donald Trump own this ice cream now, or do you got a piece of the action?
I have a piece of the action after a year.
Oh! No one's going to care in a year.
Wait, don't say that. Please, don't say that.
Someone else, there's going to be another ice cream in a year.
You just throw me away. But discard me like your cum-filled socks in the bottom of the bed, don't you?
I'm looking out for you. Oh, that Donald Trump is tough, is what I'm getting at. You come up with this amazing flavor, and you don't get the action until a year from now.
This has longevity.
Yeah, people will come back for
this. You think it has longevity?
Plus, Penn's famous enough to go out and promote it yourself after. It's like
you are famous, Penn.
Well, thank you.
You're very
famous. Thinner too.
Oh my God!
I'm thinner and famous. They go together. Look at Angelina Jolie. So I'm a finalist. I'm a finalist on the show.
Congrats.
It's me and Trey. We don't know. I think it should be very, very close. But the funny thing is, every other year, most of the years, they've had real animosity with the two finalists.
Right.
And Trace and I get along great.
You get along, yeah.
Get along wonderfully. There's no animosity. Because, you know, why would there be animosity on a television show? But there sometimes is.
Yeah, well, people get very competitive.
Sometimes we're competitive. We're doing the best
drama.
We can.
I think sometimes they make drama, you know? You guys get along, though?
Mm-hmm. Very well.
You performers.
Yeah.
This ice cream's ridiculous.
I gave mine to Sam. I ate like fucking five bites. And
it's crazy.
You're not going to get mad if I throw this away because I can't eat this whole fucking thing.
Give it to like Roland.
It's too good.
Give it Roland to eat it.
It's so goddamn good.
I'm not. Wow. And it's only until Saturday that it counts.
I've gotten to the salt part.
You know, there's a bunch of, every Walgreens, every Duane Reade has it. I suggest very strongly you not even try his flavor.
Yeah.
If you try his flavor, it doesn't help me at all.
Let me tell you something. Don't try his flavor because the guy hasn't come on our show.
He doesn't come on your show?
No, it's all about Penn Jillette.
Good.
Don't even try the other flavor. Just buy Penn's ice cream.
That's like macadamia maple. It sounds terrible.
Yeah, well, I don't care for it, but some people do.
Maple's only good on pancakes.
That's a niche.
That's it.
That's a niche flavor.
This is a flavor for the people.
This is universal.
This is the people's flavor.
You got your vanilla and your chocolate right in there. Fuck it. All American. You are... I'm like
goddamn good.
I'm tempted to just keep eating.
I never really eat ice cream.
I'm sea salting my ass off right now.
Oh, fucking amazing.
Look at this. Shit.
One more. All right, one more big fucking.
How does he compete? What other one sounds awful.
Yeah, well, you know,
terrible.
It would be nice to win. If I do not win, if I do not bring home the bacon for O&A, will you still love me?
Yeah. Yes.
I like you more if you lose because I'll relate to you.
Oh, by the way, on Penn Sunday School, for those who listen, this Sunday is Jim's show.
Oh, good.
Because I'll
be
here doing Celebrity Apprentice. We're rolling that in now.
Nice.
So you'll be on. That was a really good show.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I understand why you have him on here. He's good all the time.
Finally.
Thank you.
Jimmy's great.
Finally have an understanding
sort of
why we have this guy on here.
Sam, you're enjoying your ice cream?
It's delicious.
When is the finale for Celebrity Apprentice? This weekend?
Sunday, yeah.
Okay, so we're right there now.
Yeah.
And that's live?
Yeah.
It is, okay.
Well, they do, they roll in about, it's a 2-hour show, they roll in about an hour. And then we come out and they try to get us to, I guess, arm wrestlers.
How hard is it not to tell people you're a finalist?
You know,
you had to keep that quiet for how long now? 4 or 5 months?
What if in my skill set, keeping secrets is there?
That's a fucking magician.
That is true.
Oh, fuck me,
you know,
man.
I could deliberately mislead you if I want. Yes. I don't even have to do that.
This
is
like,
you know, and the NBC says to me, you know, this is very important that you keep. I go, yeah, we catch bullets in our teeth.
I think I can handle this.
Yeah. I talk an awful lot, but you'd be surprised at how much I'm shutting up.
How little you say. Yes.
I don't give you the hints when I'm not supposed to. No idea. And I do want to say, because something is that my charity, Opportunity Village, which is what you'll be buying the ice cream for at Walgreens, Duane Reade, it was Elvis's favorite charity.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you know the scarves that Elvis used to take off his neck and wipe his brow and kiss and throw. Every single one of those was made at Opportunity Village. Opportunity Village, you know, people with intellectual disabilities, gives them jobs, helps them get jobs in the community. But they also had a workshop that just made Elvis scarves.
Jeez.
So as I said to Mr. Trump, and I will say again on the finale, I said, you know, if you're not for me, you're against my charity. And if you're against my charity, you're against Elvis. And if you're against Elvis, sir, fuck you. I mean, what else can he say? Yeah, he used to, every one of the scarves that he would take. And I have one of the scarves.
And the women would go,
one of the real Elvis ones.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
The guy would, who is that would put it on his back? Elvis would throw one out, and then someone would drape one on his back.
Yeah,
put a new one on.
I forget the guy's name. That's the thing with Elvis.
Would go wild.
With the Beatles, you know everybody in the band, George Martin, everything. With Elvis, there's just Elvis. Maybe Scotty Moore. Maybe you know the guitar player. But if you say to somebody, you know, who's Elvis's favorite drummer? No idea.
No idea.
So the guy that put the scarves on, not a chance.
He's way out of the mix. Yeah.
I met his best friend at Dice's wedding, Jerry.
Okay, I'm getting close to you there.
Yeah, Jerry.
You got that Elvis connection.
A little bit.
You're the brother of the guy who put the scarves on Elvis.
I don't know what he did. Jerry something. I don't know what it is.
But he's saying he was best friends with Elvis.
Would Elvis say the same thing if he was alive? Yeah, he's in all the fucking Elvis videos. I keep dipping into the damn ice cream.
I'm actually staring at Penn's ice cream
like it's tits.
Because I don't want to throw it away in front of him.
That's not the reason. You're actually enjoying it, aren't you?
I already said I'm enjoying it, but I'm enjoying it so much I don't want to eat the whole damn thing.
I just gave mine to fucking Sam.
I'd save it for later, but it's going to melt all over the place.
I would never have thought that's sea salt. You taste it in the chocolate.
Sea salt's the shit.
A little salt in there.
Yeah, it's good ice cream.
We get the dark chocolate with the sea salt at home.
Oh, God,
we got
to
little caramel.
We got to go into a lab, like a food lab. And I'm thinking they're putting us in the coats and shit. I'm thinking, this is wanky. This is just fucking TV.
Yeah.
And then you go in there, and there's actually a person whose life is making ice cream. You know, and they get all this stuff, and she goes, "Well, what do you like?" And I started telling her. You know, I was thinking like a turtle type thing, some sea salt, some chocolate. And she said, "Can't use the word turtle; it's trademark." Because I thought I would have turtle ice cream. It's called Swirtle. I would get turtle ice cream, and then I would get Howard Kalin and Mark Volman, who are friends of mine, the Turtles, to play at the final party. You know, turtle ice cream. They said, "Oh no, turtles with ice cream. Other people own that. That's copyright problems."
They do, huh?
So we went with Went with Swirtle.
I like Swirtle. It's kind of catchy.
It's very catchy.
It's got the swirl of chocolate in there.
Hey, did you ever think you would see someone you knew on the carton of a dairy product, Jim, that wasn't locked in your closet?
No, not at all. Exactly. I've got quite a few of the milk cartons autographed.
Magic really Swirtle. There it is.
Yeah. Nice. And a picture of me.
Yes.
You know? A picture of me on an ice cream.
Stare at that while you spoon out the ice cream.
Exactly.
Treat for the palate and the eyes.
Let your mind go wild as you eat the ice cream.
So what happens? You go through the process of trying it, and you take a bite, like, and then they call you back in an hour, and they go, "All right, we've done this."
They have this this monster instant freeze machine. You know, and you kind of go, "The vanilla's a little cloying." And they go, "Okay, let's pull it back a little bit." And they go, and you go, and Dennis Rodman has this incredibly sophisticated ice cream palate. So Dennis Rodman's sitting there going, "A little bit more salt."
Really?
And she goes, "Okay." And you're going, "Wow." Because I was satisfied with the ice cream like 3 steps before Dennis was.
Right.
You know? And so Dennis is just tasting. Then Dennis goes, "It's perfect." Like, "Okay, Dennis, go get dressed for the party."
You just brought him along, or he was on your team?
He was on my team.
We had
Dennis, LaToya, and Lisa Rinna were my team. And we put it together.
How's LaToya? Is she nuts?
is
she nuts?
No, she isn't.
I know. That's why I'm asking you.
It's surprising.
People that have met her say that she's not nuts, but she certainly portrays that she's
remarkable because
nuts.
I didn't get to work with Dennis or with LaToya for the whole season. And then they threw them on my team at the end as kind of a change-up, see how we do. And LaToya, I was kind of hesitant because I had never worked with her. So I thought that she was nuts. And I thought she was really straightforward and kind of smart. I don't mean, smart like Richard Feynman smart. Like, I don't think Stockholm is on the phone going, "Which Nobel do we give her?" It's kind of tough. It's either chemistry or medicine. She's got both in the bag. We can't give her both. Which do we do? I don't think Stockholm's having any trouble
with that. No.
No. But for show business, which, is a whole, that's the Special Olympics of intellect.
Who's she above in smarts? Who's just below her in smarts?
Just below her in smarts. I don't know. Probably Stephen Baldwin.
Okay. All right. Very good answer. Yeah.
That is a very good answer.
And I like them both, and LaToya's great. And then LaToya, Teller comes in for the final task, and the cameras are all rolling, and LaToya's having this conversation with Teller. And Teller's looking at her and smiling, and she takes about 5 minutes to realize that Teller doesn't talk. And then we realize that LaToya Jackson has never heard of Penn & Teller.
No! She's one of them!
That sucks.
Absolutely great. Man. And so she learns that Telly doesn't talk. Unlike Leon Russell. You know, I was on Fallon with Leon Russell, who's a big hero of mine. You know, played with the Wrecking Crew on every single from like 61 to 64. The piano was Leon Russell. Mm-hmm. Every single that comes out, you know, from Gary Lewis, you know, in the Playboys to all that stuff is all Leon Russell. And of course, then the Joe Cocker and then his stuff on his own. And he's there in a wheelchair with a long beard and the long hair. And I walk up and I go, "Mr. Russell, so nice to meet you." He goes, "I don't suppose your partner's going to talk to me."
Oh, there you go.
Went, wow,
so he knows.
Wow. Leon Russell knows.
Because that, I'm okay with that. With people that, like, Leon Russell should never have heard of Penn and Teller. He's got better things to do. But LaToya Jackson, she's got 5 minutes. Find out who Penn and Teller are.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? But I had them on my team, and the surprising thing about Celebrity Apprentice is, first of all, everybody else bitches about the hours because you work from like 5 a.m. to 10 p.m. And that's like my usual work day, so I'm okay.
Yeah.
But everybody else is like, whoa, that's long and tedious. And it's also pretty fun because you get to go into a lab and see how they make ice cream, which I didn't know.
I know, like a lab, you just think, oh, it's, you know, they bring in some milk and freeze it. And, you know, so I think there's like a lab coat and people in a sterile environment doing testing.
Yeah. And also, as you said, you think you leave for like 2 hours and come back. Mm. You don't think they got magic cold machine for like a James Bond villain, you know, Batman, Mr. Freeze. Oh, you want ice cream instantly? Bang!
You would think the quality wouldn't be as good out of that instant freezing.
Well, have you
thing.
Ever had liquid nitrogen ice cream?
No.
Oh, then you have not lived, sir.
Really?
Find yourself a supplier because it's illegal. Because, you know, when I do, other people do illegal stuff, it's like drugs and hookers. I do illegal stuff, it involves sub-zero gases.
Right.
But you can get yourself, through a welding company and a little bribe on the side, you can get yourself a container of liquid nitrogen. Mm-hmm. You know, they used to do in the school shows, they freeze a banana and smash it. And then you just take a metal mixing bowl, and you put in some cream, some sugar, you know, some Swirtle, put that into a bowl, just a soup, and then you take a doer, as it's called in the chemistry biz. See, Stockholm's got me on speed call. And you pour it into there while you mix it. Now, of course, if you spill too much on, you get frostbite and you, you know, die.
Yeah, true.
But, you know, that's why they try to keep it illegal. Fucking pigs. And just because it can really fuck you up making ice cream. And then you stir it in, and really in like 6 seconds, it makes a whole batch of ice cream. And of course, it's liquid nitrogen, so it goes right into the air. It's gone.
Yep.
There are no bubbles in it, nothing. It's just this really smooth, beautiful ice cream made really, really wicked fast.
Why isn't that supplied to the people, like in stores?
Well, because making it with liquid nitrogen is really dangerous. See, I'm suggesting when you do stuff that's dangerous, it's like heroin, which there's a really strong upside to it.
Right.
You know.
That is true. The upside, the downside is you lose your hand. The upside is the ice cream is terrific.
Exactly. And risk-reward, it's not up there with heroin. It's just not in the same. Risk-reward with heroin is you've got some sores all over your body, and you feel like you're coming 24 hours a day. That's a good risk-reward, right? A few sores on your body, I feel great. But lose a hand, have a good thing of ice cream, you've got to be in that special pendulum.
Well, this is pretty good, though.
I know this is
no
really,
nitrogen
really good.
Used, but
it's
pretty goddamn good.
Ridiculously good.
Yeah,
I know. I keep digging in.
And you guys will be. I'm sure your listeners will run out and buy cases, and also, you know, hide traces, you know, over behind the rocky road or something.
Yeah, you don't need that.
Yeah, you don't need that at all.
Terrible flavor, and then there's this wonderful.
Where do they go again? Walgreens.
Well, Walgreens, which is Duane Reade.
It's the whole thing.
Yeah. But you're national. You're bad. You're nationwide.
Oh, yeah, so
it's
crazy.
It's Walgreens most of the places.
I love that song. ZZ Top.
But I'm not even kidding. People are asking me on Pal Talk here. They're like, is it really is it really good, Anthony? Or are you just saying? I'm like, because, no, this is fucking great.
Because you would lie on the air, but on Pal Talk.
Not on Pal Talk. Exactly. Right.
You would go in and type. Yeah, I'm saying it's good, but boy, it really sucks. Yeah.
That must be a new.
We sure pulled it over on all those people.
That's got to be a new listener because they all know we'll tell if it's good or not after he leaves.
Exactly. Yeah.
You're gonna let Penn go. He's got a busy.
He's a very
day.
Busy man. Yeah.
They're telling us, by the way.
Amazing.
For real.
Amazing ice cream. I love this stuff. I'm going out and buying some.
Good.
And bringing it home.
Please.
Yeah.
Cases. And it only counts till Saturday.
Oh,
there will still
cases.
Be ice cream after that, but I don't give a fuck about it after that. I want for my charity, buy it right now, get the ice cream, and it's wicked good.
It's
one
great.
Of the few times you can actually eat ice cream and be helping a charity. Yeah. This money does not go to a certain Penn Jillette. This money, I mean, for all you want to be cynical about Celebrity Apprentice, I am looking, if I do it right, $350,000.
That's great.
For a charity that really does great work.
That's huge.
Of course, if I lose, it's $350,000 to a charity that also does great work. But anyway.
But you want to be the guy.
I would like to be the guy.
So we're not even going to mention the other guy.
No, but I think you're in.
But you're selling ice cream with the other guy right here in New York City. Penn Jillette's Swizzle, right? And,
Swirtle.
Swizzle.
Jesus.
Swirtle.
Yes,
but the problem is Swirtle's really small on the packaging. All right.
There
go,
he goes.
Go buy Penn's ice cream.
It's look, he's not in the room. It's so fucking good.
Yeah, of course.
I can't stop eating this shit.
Your sister came to our show.
Yes, she loves you.
Yeah. Oh, in Vegas?
Yeah, Dawn came. And, she loved the show. She just fucking can't say
you
enough about
really, it. Really not hard to believe she's your sister.
Why, you know, they have to carry her out drunk?
I didn't have to ask for any ID whatsoever.
Yeah.
She said it just, you know, there's a family resemblance.
Yeah,
there's a style.
Dawn rules.
She was great.
She had such a great time. She was thrilled to death to meet you.
People were thrilled she was in the audience. Because she came up and, you know, after the show and announced pretty clearly who she was.
She's hilarious.
And people around were like, oh, yeah, oh, and
What a yap on her.
That's great.
What a yap on her.
She was posing for pictures of us together, but then also for other people.
Oh, that's hilarious. She's a pisser. She had such a great time, though.
Yes.
She loves your show.
Yeah, we had a wonderful. We didn't know she was there. You should have let us know.
We would have
set you up and stuff. But she just came like a regular punter.
Yeah, like a regular person.
Yeah. We didn't give her fancy O&A nepotism seats. We have the O&A nepotism section, but that was empty that night. And there she was.
it's a great show, man. It's just. What a blast!
Well, thank you. Yeah, it's great. You know, we're doing. I got to tell you, Celebrity Apprentice sure moves tickets. I mean, we're filled up all the time now.
It opens you up to people that probably normally wouldn't.
It's amazing, you know. And forgive me if this sounds unpleasant, but I thought that there were a lot of people who didn't like Penn and Teller, but I didn't know there were that many people who had never heard of Penn and Teller.
You know,
no idea. People that come to the show and go, I never heard of you guys until Celebrity Apprentice.
I've been around for
that's
long?
Unbelievable.
Yeah. And you just, and you know, and I say, and they love the show. And now they're new fans. And now I say, well, in terms of economics, the people you want coming to your show are people that have never heard of you before, because then you're starting a whole new market. But I just go, man, I thought you all made your decision on us
a long time ago.
93.
Right.
About 93, you decided they suck or I like them. The battle lines were drawn, and you moved on through your life. You know,
who are these? I don't even know who they are.
Penn and Teller,
right?
No clue. And really, they would come in after the show. They go, I didn't know you did a magic show.
Oh my God!
I signed a Celebrity Apprentice. And we just did one of the Indian casinos somewhere, you know, Biloxi or something, you know.
Yeah. Mm.
And this guy comes up to me. I'm on my way to the steakhouse before the show, and he says to me, "Watch your Celebrity Apprentice. No idea what you do, but I'm coming to see you tonight."
Wow.
I mean, now that's a great deal of support.
Yeah.
That's really great. I just kind of go, wow, no idea what I do.
Boy, way, that's kind of a kick in the ass. But kind of like, shit.
Saturday Night Live, Letterman,
right.
You know, bullshit, all those things just blew right by. There's a certain segment of the population that doesn't know, you know? And I was talking to Bob Dylan's manager, who said, you think you're surprised.
Oh, wow.
No.
All right.
No fucking way.
And I said, no fucking way.
No fucking way.
Occasionally I'm on the phone and I'll say I work with Bob Dylan and they'll go, who?
No, come on.
I went, okay, I'm fine with this then.
Now you're fine, Wow.
And then he started listing things. He said Fargo. Everybody you know saw Fargo, right?
Yeah.
I go, yeah. He goes, not a very successful movie. Goodfellas. Everybody you know saw Goodfellas, right? Yeah. A lot of people haven't heard of it. He said, just, you know, Elvis used to go crazy.
Who?
That there was...
Perfectly timed.
That there were Aboriginal people in New Guinea.
Yeah.
That had not heard of him, you know? And I got over that long ago. I realized that out of the 7 billion people on the planet,
right.
7 billion haven't heard of Penn and Teller. You know, if you round it off, 7 billion haven't heard of him. I kind of thought this small little chunk of the world, this, you know, 350 to 400 million, this tiny little drop of humanity, who uses most resources, a tiny little drop of humanity had kind of, and I'm not saying... Beloved.
Right.
And I'm not saying no well.
Aware,
I'm just saying
aware.
Just saying, oh, Penn and Teller, nah. You know,
right,
that's
right.
All I'm requiring out of you. Penn and Teller, nah. You know, that's
know that I exist.
But just those two words together with an ampersand between them mean nothing.
Nothing.
You know, hegemony. It's the same exact thing. I don't know what that word means. Don't know what Penn and Teller mean. Boom. No idea.
I wanted to ask you something about bullshit because I was watching it recently. I fucking love the show. Was it harder as time went on to get people that weren't onto the fact that you might fucking say some
nasty
shit about them?
Let me tell you, you know, I have a real problem with Michael Moore and even with Borat. You know, I have a little problem with misrepresenting.
Right.
We would go to the people and say, we do a show called Bullshit. Here is a DVD. Penn and Teller disagree with you. Do you want to go on the show? You know, that's what we would say.
And next thing you say, I'm Dr. Maury Smith, and I think...
And we had all sorts of video of people, like, picking their nose and all this stuff. We would never use it. We tried to attack ideas. As a matter of fact, as the years went on, I kept saying, well, you know, we can be mean to the guys on our side.
Yeah.
So we actually would have more trouble getting people to agree with us because they'd go, I've been noticing the show.
Yeah, it's a trend.
You attack our ties and how we look and our hair.
Yeah.
Like, well, that's because we agree with you. We don't want to make it too easy for you. You know, so like the guys from Reason Magazine, like Nick Gillespie and those, like the libertarian guys,
right.
We would call up like every three shows and have the same people on, people from the Cato Institute and stuff. We'd have them on. They'd go, well, last time you had me on, you like really fucked with me. We go, yeah, we agree with everything you said. They said, yeah, but what's wrong with my suit jacket?
Or a hair or something. You're constantly bad.
But, you know, we would have, and there's a sad side of this, too, which is that everybody that we would have on and bash and tear to pieces, just rip a new asshole, they would do better after they were on the show.
Oh, man. Yeah, well. Yeah.
So they all knew that, you know, and they all knew they would go through that. And they also knew that we would attack their ideas, but not their, you know, we did one thing on the show which I thought was really funny. I did this thing where I said, you know, people think we take people out of context. They think that we pull out the stupidest thing they say. We would like to show you a minute and a half of what we get as raw material, not out of context. And we had one of the, I think it was on the Bible show, the creationism show, we had a guy do his full hunk without editing. And it was really funny. Because we would do our editing to make them look better because, you know, if you're doing drama, your hero is only as strong as your villain.
Right.
Right.
Yes.
So if you have people that are too you know, James Bond wants to have a really, really good villain.
Yeah.
You don't want James Bond going up against a 16-year-old shoplifter. Yes, you know,
boom, boom, boom. So it's easy to discredit somebody if their argument sucks or they're stupid.
We would spend all this time making the enemies look really, really good and concise so that I could come in and they go, man, Penn just took that fucker apart.
Yes.
Whereas in reality, if you saw the full hour and a half, you know, a 6-year-old could have taken them apart. You know, so we would be boying people up.
Yeah.
But they always knew. And the amazing thing I'll tell you, we did, you know, 8 years of bullshit. 8 years, like something like almost 90 shows, I think. And not one lawsuit that stuck at all. I mean, one person threatened, two people threatened, but never took legal action. And that's as close as they came. So we were really careful, and you would love, and I told you this last time, but it's worth repeating, you know, the lawyers, we worked with the same lawyers for 8 years, and they would get really good at giving notes, the notes of the script, and we really should have these up on the web or something, because in this very, very legal hand of a $600 an hour lawyer, they would say, not sure about this wording, could you call him cocksucker instead? Not sure if this is actionable. Maybe pull out cunt pickle. You know? Pull out that. Would that be better? And then circled. And then you also see stuff you never thought you'd see. You never saw in your high school paper, which is cunt pickle circled next to it. Good. We're really safe. Because, you know, after 8 years, you really run out of obscenity.
Oh, true. Yeah,
you know,
You
say
the same old thing over and over.
We've used motherfucker 8 times in this show.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know, we need something else. And when they told us, I was really proud of this. They told us for the chiropractor show that absolutely nowhere in the show, any place, could I even hint at the word quack.
Quack.
They said, you say the word quack, I'm telling you, you lose your house. Yeah. It's that simple. They're all listening. Their lawyers are all on. Keep that away. And by the way, for those listening now, I'm not saying chiropractors are quacks.
Course.
I'm just saying we couldn't say those two things. So I'm going, you know, I just feel like such a pussy not being able to use the word the whole show. So I said for the shoot, I wrote in the script, you know, for the call sheet, I wrote, we want 100 ducks.
Yes.
100 ducks. And we just dumped ducks all over the set. And I was just going, sue them. Brilliant. Just sue them all you want. So I'd be going, you know, we're talking about
chiropractic.
And I never said it, and the ducks are all over, and we never even explained.
Yeah.
We never said, like, they're speaking for us.
Oh,
never underlined and nothing. Just all. And we did the multi-level marketing.
I love that one.
The word you can't use is pyramid.
Right.
So we had a you know, a blue screen of Gaza behind us with the pyramids, and we were in Egyptian outfits, and no mention of pyramid scheme.
You couldn't say that word?
No.
No.
Wait, are you worried too? When you say like they're all watching, like if you say so and so is a quack or this profession's a quack, that people watching in that profession can sue because you're hurting them, or just people?
It's very, very difficult. If we say chiropractic in general, but our problem was we had a particular person on screen.
Right, okay.
And then if the show included that, that could be all stopping them from making a living, defamation of character. There's all sorts of things that are there. And also all sorts of things that I hate it when this is true, but a lot of times the law is correct. You know, and you shouldn't be able to rip an individual apart without me doing due diligence. And what exactly would be due diligence for me to call someone a quack? I mean, how much research do I have to do before, in good conscience? I'm not even talking legally, but morally, how much do you have to know before you discredit someone's entire medical practice? Now, in general, it's really easy to do, and in theory, it's really easy to do, but an individual, you want to be very, very careful.
And they could easily call people that would say, this person helped me and changed my life.
Sure.
So that, there goes your argument. Yeah. Right there.
That poor bastard that was selling the drinks on that multi-level.
That was heartbreaking.
I felt so bad for that.
That was one of the shows where we didn't really have villains.
No, we
were so much victims on their side.
It was just a fucking cast of victims, that show.
Can you explain? I don't
I didn't see that one.
Multi-level marketing are like when they have a product that you sell to your friends.
Right, right, of course.
And there's always X amount of money to get in. So you pay $5,000 and you get a case of this stuff that you're going to sell to
your
friends.
And it's never about selling the stuff. It's about selling the business to another
person. Of course.
Right. So the stuff, you can't possibly make money on the stuff. No, yeah. You sell the whole business.
Yeah, I want to know about the guy that you felt sorry for.
You know, we did this when there was a real downturn in the economy, and a lot of people who'd lost their jobs were investing $5,000, $10,000, $15,000 of their savings to get into this business, and then trying to get their other friends into it, and then finding out that they didn't want to rip off their friends, and had a cellar full of shit they couldn't sell, and had also taken, I mean, if you lose your job, even if you don't lose your job, $5,000 is a serious chunk of change.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like, we're not looking at people losing like $100, you know,
which
still is a serious amount of change. That's a lot of groceries. I don't mean to dismiss that. But I'm talking about $5,000 changes what you do for the next 2 months.
Yeah.
It really does change what you do. No matter who you are, that changes it. And we were getting people to put this money in, and these were people who had been ripped off and sucked in, and, you know, were on camera going, you know, I'm not going to sell this business to my friends because I would just be ripping off my friends.
Yeah, because they realize, like, it just doesn't.
So I guess I'm just kind of eating this.
When he went to, when that one guy.
How bad was the product, though?
It doesn't matter.
I mean, it's a widget. It doesn't matter at that point.
The products are all okay.
Just okay, though.
You know?
Yeah.
But, I mean, they're not. It doesn't matter.
Not worth pushing.
It doesn't matter how good they are. The fact is you can't make money unless you sell the whole business.
Yeah.
And it's simple. It's one of those simple things you see.
It's shaped like a checkerboard. Triangle.
Right, right. Yeah, exactly. Like a three-dimensional triangle.
Legally, why wouldn't somebody classify as pyramid? Is the pyramid thing kind of like a, is that a copywritten thing?
Pyramid is a legal term.
Oh.
A Ponzi scheme or pyramid. Like a Ponzi scheme would be, let's say, Social Security.
There you go.
Which is, if you get it early, you make a lot of money. I'm just telling you right now, if you're under 25, Social Security, you're getting fucked.
Just in case
no one else has told you that, at least you can hear it on O&A. All the money you put into Social Security, you are not getting it back.
Look,
it's
at
as simple
classic
as that.
Pyramid schemes. The base can never support
on
top of
the
it.
The big trick of a pyramid scheme is be the first guy.
Be that fucking pointy stone.
if you haven't thought of the pyramid scheme yourself, you don't want to be involved in it.
Exactly.
If you've thought of it yourself, you've got a good chance getting your money back.
I went to one of those. I remember the company name and everything. When I was newly sober, a guy in the program took me, and I was probably like 1988 or something like that, and he took me to one of these companies, and I was like, oh, God, this is a good... And then something inside me went, shit.
Well, I got taken to an Amway. It was Amway meeting.
Yeah.
And no one... It's very vague. No one wants to tell you what it is. Like, just come. It's a great opportunity. And you're like, what? What is it? No, it's got to be presented. The whole thing's
got to
be presented.
They never tell you first.
You can't tell. So I sit there, and there's a woman, and she's got a chalkboard, and she's writing. And she's
making a big triangle.
And she's going and going and going. Yeah. And I'm sitting there going like, what the fuck is this? And she goes, well, this was known as, and she writes on the blackboard. She's like, the American way. It's like, this is the American way selling things. She goes, we shortened it to Amway. And I'm like, fuck, they got me. Fuck.
That's brilliant.
God damn it. And I'm sitting there like, oh, gosh.
See, I'm thinking the big mistake is getting people who are newly sober.
Yeah.
Don't you want people shit-faced drunk?
Right. What a great idea.
Well, maybe when you're new, you're eager to change your life and do something. Like, I'll just sell this stuff. It'll be great.
Were you actually selling the stuff, Ann, for a while?
No. I was fucking like pissed that I had to stay the rest of the meeting.
Yeah, you were like...
I was the second she's at Amway, because I'd heard about Amway. I never knew how it was presented. If I did, I would have known this
the
was
presentation
Amway
thing. And you were like,
so when they
this.
Got me and I'm like, what is she getting
right,
at
right,
fucking
right, right.
Get to the point. Oh, fuck, it's Amway.
How long was it? How long was the meeting?
It seemed like it's still going on.
It's like the timeshare. You ever gone to one of the timeshare thing?
Where they say free this and free that. You just got to go to the timeshare.
Get a free hibachi. Just sit through the whole thing.
Meanwhile, why don't you calculate what your time as a human is worth per hour and how much that hibachi ends up costing you?
I'm worth more than a hibachi.
In your time, right?
Lady.
Well, the hibachi is also, because I went, because I wanted to learn about it.
Yeah.
So I went to the full timeshare. In Vegas, you know, timeshare capital. Oh, yeah, they pull people off the strip and, you know, to get a hibachi. And it was, I think, 4.5 hours to get a hibachi that I thought was probably worth about $3.
Right.
How does it work, the timeshare?
A timeshare is you buy a property that you can use 2 weeks a year.
Oh, 2 weeks. Okay.
So, you know, or 3 weeks, whatever
we
you
want.
We
had one in our family.
Yeah. You chip in with a bunch of people and they get them.
Well, there's a family. There's a company that sells them, and they break them up.
Basically, you got to go on vacation to the same shitty fucking condo every year. That's what it comes down to.
And you
to.
Have to, how far in advance do you work out what weeks are yours?
All that depends.
It looks great at first, but then year after year, you're going back to the same place.
They'll also tell you that you can trade that for another place.
You buy
your timeshare in Terre Haute, and you can get the one in, you know, Aspen.
Sure. Yeah, sure. Yeah, and that, sure you can.
It turns out that deal's a little hard to make.
Yes. Yeah, because why would the Aspen guy go to your shitty place?
Yeah.
You're right.
But they do them everywhere, and every family has somebody in them that did that. And all you've got to do is you've got to do the arithmetic, but you've got to do it on your own.
Right.
Yeah. You can't do the arithmetic with the guy there helping you.
No.
Which is always good advice on any business deal. Do your arithmetic in private. Don't have the guy who's making the deal with you go, yeah, you don't have to carry the three.
Yeah. Oh, I guess I don't have to carry the three.
Okay, right. No, just add it right now.
Whatever
spot.
You say.
Yeah.
Opie Anthony's worst of 2013.
I gotta help out Penn Jillette because I'm learning the country guy, is the favorite here, right?
Country artists have the whole country. I forgot about that.
Trace Adkins is a formidable opponent because number one,
but he has a shitty ice cream. No one likes maple in their ice cream.
Hi, this is Trace Adkins.
He's got a great voice, man.
Doesn't he? That guy's
fucking voice is so deep, and his talking voice, he does like a PSA or commercial or some shit, and he's just, hi, this is Trace. You can't even imitate it. It's like all bottom end.
Do we know any of his songs?
Yeah.
He's big in country.
I'm Trace Adkins. You know a Trace Adkins song? For real?
Yeah.
I don't think I do. Yeah.
Dancing by the Meadow.
No, it isn't. Oh, yeah. This is new country, bitches. Ladies love country, boys.
Do women want to fuck him?
What was that? Jimmy!
I'm sorry, ice cream.
Oh, my God.
Ice cream, you scream.
Ice cream farts in the studio.
Listen how deep that is.
Daddy wore a tie, mama never fried a chicken. Ballet, straight A's, most likely to.
Where is that, Atlanta?
Oh, Penn Jillette's fucked.
4.5 million hits
chicks
on this.
Love this Trace
Four and
Adkins
a half
guy.
Million hits on that fucking video.
Yeah. He gets pussy if he wants it.
He's done.
Yeah.
Poor
plus
Penn.
The country guys get money. I don't know how they do it.
What do you mean?
But on the show, like, you know, they do fundraising things.
Yeah.
And you just call your rich, the celebrities call whatever rich celebrities they know to bring money.
Yeah.
And like the country guys, especially like Trace, they get six figures from people.
Wow. Jesus. Penn's so fucked.
Could you find a Trace Adkins
his ice cream's
PSA?
Way better,
I think Trace Adkins PSA. See if you can find. Yeah, play one of these. Listen to his speaking voice. It's insane.
Food allergies result in more than 300,000 ambulatory care visits each year among children. Hi, I'm Trace Adkins, and my daughter Brianna is one of the 3 million children in the U.S. living with potentially life-threatening food allergies. To learn more about food allergies, please speak with your doctor or visit foodallergy.org. More than 12 Americans
have. He could like have a broadcasting career if he didn't have a semi-successful country career. Oh, that's right.
Everybody.
A public service from FAM, the Food Allergy and Anaphylaxis
The FAM.
Network.
Public service from the FAM.
Plus, he's playing for the American Red Cross.
Of course.
So,
you
know, oh, Penn's so fucked. Yeah. And his ice cream is.
I forgot the Middle America country. Like, country is the number one music. And
no, it's not a vote.
No? What?
It's not a vote. But people can't. Donald
they gotta
Trump
get out
picks.
And buy it. But,
right,
so, but if they sell a lot of fucking ice cream,
right?
I'm gonna buy Trace Adkins ice cream. I don't even know who that Jew is. That Penn.
Yeah.
It's not a Jew.
He's a big Jew who don't like God. I like Trace, and I like God.
I like an artist that loves the Lord, not the tribe that done killed him.
Yeah.
What?
He makes a lot of things disappear. What? I don't trust him.
That Penn Jillette. Jillette. Isn't that Penn Jillette? He looks like a Jew. I just assumed.
They both got ponytails. You might as well go with Trace.
I'm just glad I ain't got to pick a nigger.
Oh, my God.
What?
Wow.
Well, that's how they talk.
I mean, and Lil Jon was in the Final Four, so.
He was?
Yeah. Whew.
Thank God they got him out there.
You got some trickery. You wanted to say that word today, and you figured out how to say it.
Please, it was the 20th time I said it already. This hour.
It's 21, right, Ant?
20th.
Oh, shit.
Fuck yeah, the cops.
Chipper doesn't care.
I fucking had a fight with the cops. Fuck yeah, I threw all their guns away. I'm like, go pick them up, Flatfoot.
Flatfoot.
What's Trace's ice cream? Maple and what else?
Macadamia.
Macadamia maple.
God, who wants that shit?
You know what, macadamia
and maple? What's the basic flavor? Like in Penn Jillette. Oh, so they're, all right.
Yeah.
But so vanilla is like the base, and then it's maple and...
Maple and macadamia.
But it's got his picture on it?
Yes, it
does. What does his ice cream carton look like? Let's see Trace's picture. Because Trace is one of those country guys. He looks like a real man and everything.
I bet it's the same as Penn's, or nobody did the design.
You think?
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Oh, same as man, Penn's. Look, with the cowboy hat, though, he's like, hi, I'm Trace Adkins.
Exactly, and who's a little more sexy? Let's be honest.
Trace has his shirt unbuttoned a little bit up top. Penn looks like a fucking... Penn looks like someone that worked on the fucking Manhattan Project.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, our pal's fucked.
Penn Jillette looks like he could be Jewish. And
he does. Yeah, and Trace looks like a good time party fucking country boy. I know.
Why didn't Penn Jew it down a little bit?
I know.
Fuck.
They actually have him standing in front of a bank with his fist raised.
Oh, my God. You had to go less Jewy.
I know.
For middle America.
Look, they actually made the lid of the ice cream a yarmulke. Pull it off. Yes. This pay is coming down the side.
You're not supposed to write, buy this and God dies a slow death. That's not going to sell.
There's a dude with a goatee and a cowboy hat and the American Red Cross logo next to him.
It couldn't be American.
Why not support the troops? Right.
I know. Penn's got a yarmulke with an Al-Qaeda thing.
Right.
Support Penn's ice cream. That's the point we're making.
You just see American flag when you look at Trace's ice cream.
That's it.
God.
Okay, what
I thought
flavor?
Penn had this.
I thought Penn had it in the bag, too, and then I realized, you know.
You know what the best part about Celebrity Apprentice this whole season was? Watching everybody go into the boardroom. And Donald Trump loves Gary Busey, so he would never fire him. And he would always say, who's the weakest player on the team?
Oh, no.
And the people would always be like, well,
Gary.
It was Gary, and then but they knew every time Donald would be like, "Yeah, but Gary's kind of a genius, so let's go beyond that."
They would let him
every time.
He would let him skate every time.
He likes Gary.
He loves Gary. Gary made it to like the top five.
I didn't watch this season.
Like the welfare system.
Fuck.
Right, why, how is that?
Well, you know, you, wow, those people that you know aren't that good and doing things. And, all right. And then they just keep getting supported and pushed along.
You're saying Donald Trump supports welfare?
And they're not contributing.
Hey, why don't we get Trump?
Gary Busey is a burden to that show, and he should be removed and sent back to where he came from.
No, it's all ratings, and he's good for the ratings.
Oh, can we get Donald Trump on the phone?
Busey, right? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Can we get Donald Trump on the phone?
We can work on that, I think.
We got to help our pal out, Penn Jillette.
How are we going to do that, though?
We'll talk to Donald himself. We're going to make sure we understand that, you know, Trace is an all-American guy, but... Penn deserves this.
One for the Jews.
We need to...
Now, what happens? What happens? Let's say Trace sells more ice cream.
Does it now instantly that
Donald Trump is going to pick him?
There are multiple tasks to this task. So you have to sell the most ice cream, but you also have to make the most money. So if Trace Adkins goes, hey, Garth Brooks, will you buy this one thing of ice cream for $2 million?
No way. 100%. They could do that?
100%.
That sounds cheating.
100% they can do it.
But that sounds like cheating.
They do it every season.
It's all for charity, so they don't care.
And they go, hey, I'm... Like, there are people on the show that are saying, you can't fire me. I'm the biggest fundraiser. And it's like, if you have famous friends...
So then Penn can make his money disappear. Trace's money disappear. Like he's a magician. Who's that?
I got more info on Trace Adkins. This guy does not lose.
What?
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Wait,
I gotta take this
phone
call. I did not know. We gotta look this up, make sure it's true. But Clint in Alabama. Clint.
Hey, guys. I don't know if he got caught cheating on her or she was just crazy, but in 1994, his ex-wife shot him through the heart and the lungs, and he lived. He don't lose.
Trace's...
Oh, yes. She shot him in 1994. His second wife shot him during an argument. He never pressed charges because he believed that she never meant to pull the trigger. He's just a nice guy.
Oh, my God.
My God. Adkins stated that their divorce was closure enough for him.
And the bullet went through his heart and his lungs?
How does that happen?
He said the only reason he lived through the incident was because he lived so close to a hospital.
Oh, my God. He's just a nice guy.
Yeah.
This is not good.
My interaction with him was very positive.
Oh, God.
You met Trace Adkins.
I walked by a window, and he, like, waved. Because he, I guess, had seen my act. And we took a picture together, and he was very nice.
Where's the picture?
I have it. I got it signed.
I don't believe you.
I don't play games.
I don't believe you.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. E-Rock saying we got to read Blue Healer's tweet. I don't know where Blue Healer's tweet is right now.
Exactly.
What does it say? Why don't you just say
who's Healer?
Okay. Says Trace Adkins has a PSA on food allergies, yet he's promoting a product with dairy and tree nuts in it.
He can't do no wrong. That's our point.
Yeah,
that's our point. He can't do no wrong.
Poor Penn.
The irony is so thick you can cut it with a knife.
Plus, Trace was in Lincoln as Lincoln's lawyer. He also has a character on King of the Hill.
Was he in Lincoln? Oh, God.
Man. Oh. And then we learn a lot of people don't even know who Penn and Teller are after years.
The thing he was talking about with LaToya was so funny. It was on the episode.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
She was like a little put off that Teller wouldn't talk to her. And then Mary Lou Henner or somebody had to be like, no, he doesn't talk. He's been doing this for 30 years.
Yeah, that's like his gimmick, you dummy.
How does she not know who Penn and Teller is?
She's in the entertainment business. That Jackson family is...
They're insulated, man.
I understand regular fucking, you know, Joes.
Yeah.
That. Might not know who Penn and Teller are, but if you're in the business, how do you not know?
Yeah.
Let's say hi to Luke in Austin, Texas. Luke?
Gentlemen, how y'all doing this morning?
We're doing all right, Luke.
Right on. If you want to hear Trace Adkins' deep, deep voice in a commercial, pull up a commercial called ASCO, A-S-C-O.
It's not funny.
Shit. The dude's voice on this commercial is...
Wait, what's it called?
ASCO, A-S-C-O.
Yes, why, why do people do that?
It's funny. ASCO, huh?
Chip loves it.
Is it an ass company that they sell, like, assholes and stuff? I don't know.
Why would they do that?
Oh, God.
All right, let's listen to this. This might be the voice you were talking
about.
All
right, maybe
this. Appreciate things like honesty, hard work, doing the job right. That's what keeps everything going. Kind of like the folks at ASCO. Hard-working people, hard-working case equipment, and good, honest value. By giving you rent to own, lease, and even return options on rugged case equipment.
He's selling
and
fucking bulldozers.
Genuine,
but he makes it seem so American.
Exactly.
That's the
Go business. Buy yourself a goddamn bulldozer. I'm Trace Adkins for fucking heavy machinery.
Where's that commercial shown? Like, I don't know.
It's got to be the Midwest.
Oh, yeah.
Texas. Yeah, you
is
need
he popular there.
Most of the country. Fucking backhoe in Texas.
Put it this way: most of the country sees that commercial.
Yeah,
we're just isolated here on the.
We don't
Northeast.
Think about that. We think, you know, the city, the Northeast,
right.
It's everything.
No.
We're the fucking minority in how this country thinks
Big
and works.
Big fucking time.
Yeah.
Well, congratulations to Trace Adkins for winning Celebrity Apprentice.
Yeah, and then another part of the task is, like, they have to make a video, like a commercial advertising the ice cream.
Right. Oh,
and, of course, Trace's is going to be all, like, families and stuff.
I'm Trace Adkins.
If you love America...
You love maple.
You love maple, fucking...
They were showing Penn editing his commercial.
Yeah.
And they came across, they didn't know what to do because they only had one close-up of the ice cream. Oh. And right behind it, you could see two showgirls bedazzled crotches.
Oh, no.
Next to the ice cream.
Oh, Donald Trump's
and he's
going to
be like,
that.
Hi, I'm Trace Adkins.
Right. I don't have any vaginas in my commercial.
No, this is about the Red Cross helping Americans.
Yeah. Show a small boy that survived a fire.
Yes.
Being soothed with ice cream salve.
And this Penn. If you like the vagina, you'll like my ice cream.
Yeah. Oh, God, Penn.
Yeah.
No bullshit.
Yeah. It's over.
Yeah. Maybe we could get Donald Trump, though,
see
on the show.
Convince
maybe,
him?
Yeah, maybe we could sway
Vaginald. Maybe I'll make Penn's a way. Hair joke.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a great
What about the Berthas?
Trace is the underdog. Because he can't. Last time he was on Celebrity Apprentice, he made it to the finals.
Uh-huh.
Piers Morgan beat him.
Then again, fucking Piers. Penn Jillette is very liked, and he has well over a million on Twitter. So Trace Adkins only has 208,000. Now, I'm not saying Twitter's everything, but he can reach a lot of people.
Wait, Trace Adkins only has a couple hundred thousand Twitter
on Twitter?
Followers?
Yeah, I have more than
him. Oh, really?
Whoa.
Mm-hmm. I did not know that. Okay, that's good. Good sign right there.
Yeah. All right. We'll see what happens.
So
I'll look see, at like, these two.
Come on. Like, who are you going to vote for?
I go with Penn Jillette. I go with the more normal, relatable guy.
Yeah. Well, the thing
but
is,
that's not what America
Trace
is.
He's not more relatable though. To more of the country.
Right. Oh, maybe he is.
It's crazy.
To me, he's not, but.
I don't even know what the hell he is. I think he's a Jew.
Some kind of Jewish.
Probably some kind of Jew, but maybe he looks a little Greek.
Yeah.
Not like American, like Trace.
Trace is obviously
Trace
American.
Trace looks American.
Penn's like a Greek Jew.
Yeah. He looks like a Greek Spanish Jew.
His ice cream is made out of pennies and weather control.
Going back to that commercial, it is being shown all over America, yeah. And he has cardboard cutouts in the stores.
Oh.
So as you're buying your bulldozer, there's a cardboard cutout.
Trace Adkins. Take a picture with him?
Yes.
Then again, everybody goes to Vegas, and you can't go to Vegas without seeing Penn on the side of a building.
That's true. You know, look, I'm pulling for Penn.
Oh, God. More info on Trace Adkins.
Oh, no.
He's a man's man.
Did he save fucking 10 children from a burning house?
Go ahead, Pete in Tennessee.
Petey!
Yeah, last year his house burned to the ground.
Oh,
so now he's got the sympathy of that.
What happened?
I don't know. He was away doing a concert, I think, in Vegas. And flew home, house burned to the ground.
You know, at least we survived. Everyone's all right. No one got hurt. I want to thank the firemen, the brave firemen that came to put the fire out.
But look, he had a safety plan in place that saved his kids.
His kids and wife. Trace Adkins loses his house to fire, but safety plan saves kids.
This guy's a miracle.
He's very thoughtful.
So all he's got to do when he's up there, if he sees Donald going like, well, Penn, you did raise the most money.
I was Trace shocked. By like, my wife.
I know when I was shot.
I
know when my house charges. Burned down.
I'm going to choose who wins this year. Did I tell you my house burnt down?
Ouch, my bullet.
Big fire.
My bullet wound is hurting me.
Yeah, thank God I put a safety plan in place for my children and my wife.
Can we push play on that? It's a video.
Yeah, let's see what the video is here. Yeah. Trace in his house.
We were just hanging out. The girls were watching TV. I was in the office messing around on the computer, and we heard this incredibly loud, like, bang explosion. It sounded like glass breaking and stuff. I mean, it was just crazy noise.
Flames flicker through a dark cloud, smoke nearly swallowing up firefighters. Neighbors peeking through the trees to see the blaze. The home of country music superstar Trace Adkins on fire.
And I ran from the office across the house to the garage.
It's the nanny?
In the garage door, there's like a big window. She's fuckable. It's off, so you can see into the garage. And all I could see were just flames and smoke.
Nanny Lindsay Weaver runs with the girls, including two of Adkins' daughters, outside to a meeting place before calling Adkins' wife, Rhonda.
And we were just 3 minutes from here. We looked up in the sky. We saw the black smoke. I started driving here as fast as I could. I put on the flashers and I just started passing people, going as fast as I could. I even passed a cop. He was like, follow me. I'm like, what
Who's
are you doing?
OJ?
My house is on fire.
Inside the house, now a total loss, are show clothes, Civil War weapons, awards, and most important to Rhonda Adkins, family pictures.
That's what I've lost. I didn't back up all that stuff. I backed up a lot of it, but not all of it.
Dummy.
And you hear people say this all the time. Take the time and copy your photos.
But in the midst of neighbors and friends looking down the street at a home submerged in smoke, the Adkins family says they're amazed. Everyone is okay.
Everybody got out. No one's hurt. My house is completely gone. But at the end of the day, it's okay.
Yeah.
Brother.
If you have kids, I guess that like when you realize your kids are alive, what else, you know?
Can I we have more info on Trace Adkins?
Oh, okay.
Oh, let's... Unless he started that fire, Penn's in trouble.
And I want Sam to back all this shit up. Okay. I don't want any of these fuckers sneaking one past us today, Sam.
Okay.
All right, but Greg in Jersey has another fact about Trace Adkins. Yes. Greg.
Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey.
Greggy.
Hey, what's up?
couple years ago, Trace has a funky finger because he had his finger amputated in an accident, and he had it reattached in a position so he could play his guitar.
Wait.
What's with this guy?
He has his finger?
But they didn't put it back normally because that would fuck up his guitar playing, so they put it back in a weird way so he could play guitar?
Oh, God.
What was the accident?
Hold on. I just found another fact while I was looking for the finger thing.
All right, but can we do the finger thing first? Or
I'm gonna confirm the finger thing.
Okay, but you want to add the other fact?
Let me add a little known fact.
Okay,
about singer Trace Adkins.
Yes,
is that his debut album "Dreamin' Out Loud" was dedicated to his brother Scott. Scott was 21 years old when he was killed in a truck accident.
Oh, Jesus! His brother was killed in a truck accident. This is just
an all-American way to die. Enough.
Now, what about his finger?
Yeah, a little-known fact about country singer Trace Adkins is that his left little finger was cut off in a work accident.
Just a working Joe.
Doctors reattached it, but his finger is permanently bent at an angle. Because of this, Trace can't play many chords on a guitar anymore.
Oh, can't.
When he does play, he does the best that he can.
Oh, he's just doing the best he can with a missing finger and shot through the heart.
He says he would love to learn the piano, but he realizes his deformed finger makes that an impossibility.
Who has
Penn? There you go, guys. I gotta go.
Thank you. Who has Penn's number?
Penn.
I don't think he realizes.
Penn is sunk.
He's in a lot of trouble.
He should just skate today. He shouldn't try at all.
No, forget the ice cream.
It's not worth it. Fuck that he has the greatest ice cream.
Doesn't matter.
So you got to go out and buy Penn ice cream.
Wait, can you make a... You know we're all about having a nice list on the show, Sam.
Yeah.
I'm losing track.
Yeah, what the fuck?
I'm losing track of how great this guy is.
Fucking...
Do you think we like lists on this show?
Yes, I
love a good list.
Maybe we... Can we do a side-by-side list? What do we know about Penn Jillette? We
Penn can has had some out. Tragedy, though. The mother, father, and sister
That's true.
Have died.
His mom made it to 95, well, I
yeah,
think.
I know, but it's never easy.
let's make the list.
Oh, man.
Okay, I'm making the track.
Trace Adkins is...
You start with Trace Adkins, has deformed finger, Penn Jillette has masterful use of his hands.
I got another Trace Adkins fact coming in.
Oh, what do you got?
It just doesn't end. Chris in Colorado. Chris.
Hey, Trace is also a spokesman for the Wounded Warrior Project.
Yes, I've heard those.
One of the top charities.
Yeah.
That's, and Penn wants
in
to
America.
Sue the Army every time an IED is destroyed.
Oh, shit. That's not looking good. For Penn.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Oh, Trace brought up a soldier in a wheelchair at the Academy of Country Music Award.
What?
A soldier in a wheelchair.
Well, it was supposed to be about him that night. He decided.
Enormously He's got by no legs. Called the Wounded Warrior Project. Tonight, the Academy of Country Music's charity, Lifting Lives, Trace Adkins, and the West Point Glee Club are helping people like me through the performance you're about to see. As you listen to this song, please consider that it's not about the war. It's about the warrior.
Oh. And now Trace gets out and...
It's a great charity.
Yeah.
Oh, it's Penn fucked.
Now he's gonna sing something real nice.
I was there in the winter of 64.
Oh, Vietnam. What?
When we camped in the ice at Nashville's door.
Nashville.
300 miles our trail had led. We barely had time to bury our dead.
Oh. This fucker really has a good voice.
When the
Jesus.
Charged and the colors fell.
Oh, 1864.
Overton Hill was a living hell.
Before that, Budinsky.
When we called a retreat, it was almost dark. I died with a grape shot in my heart.
Oh, almost dead when his wife shot him.
Say a prayer for peace.
Oh, it's the Say a Prayer for Peace commercial.
And
what a good song.
By the way, he was an oil rig worker before he was a country singer.
Really?
Yeah.
Of course he was, doing man's work.
A wildcat, what do they call him?
And we have more facts coming in.
A roughneck?
Brian in Pittsburgh. Brian.
How you doing?
Hey.
Hey, I was a couple years ago down in Nashville at the Country Music Fest, and he was performing along with a lot of other people, and this was right after his house had burned down. Apparently there were a lot of charities that popped up online, people putting together, donating money to him and his family to help rebuild and all that stuff. He announced at that concert that, A, he was taking all that money and donating it because he flat out said, hey, guys, I don't need it. Help out people that need the help. And asked anybody that donated money at that concert to give it to the homeless and stuff like that.
Oh, my.
Yeah, I love Penn, but he's kind of fucked.
He's kind of fucked on this one.
That's
why Penn was focusing on his ice cream.
Is there any scandal in Trace's life?
That song was great, wasn't it?
Oh, see.
Is that his song?
For Pete.
We'll play it.
It is one of his hits. I think.
He wrote that.
This list is not. The side by side is not looking.
I know.
Good. No.
This is the guy who created the song. Honky Tonk Badonka Donk.
That's Trace Adkins.
Ew, what song is that?
Remember that?
Yeah, we.
Honky Tonk Badonka Donk.
Big song.
He knows to have fun too. Yeah.
We went over this song with Patrice, didn't we?
Yeah. Yes, we did.
Yes.
Man,
that's a terrible song.
Oh, it's awful.
It was a huge hit. All right, are we done with the list?
Do you want me to go? I have a list for Penn and a list for Trace. I want to read the Trace list first.
All right.
All right, that's fair enough.
Okay. And you tell me who you think's
supposedly he's like the underdog.
Tell me who you think's going to win Celebrity Apprentice.
Sure.
This is Trace Adkins.
Okay.
He was shot in the heart but didn't press charges against his ex-wife for doing it.
Okay.
His house burned down, but his kids survived because they had a fire plan. He helps the Wounded Warriors Project.
Mm.
He sells bulldozers.
Mm.
His finger's been amputated, but he keeps trying. He has a wonderful voice. He's selling ice cream for the Red Cross. He used to be an oil rig worker. He gave money given to him for a new house to charity. He has billionaire friends, and he's not afraid to have a little fun.
Did you get his dead brother in there?
Yeah, what about the dead brothers?
Oh, fuck,
Sam?
How did I forget?
Sam, how you forget that one?
And I'm also hearing about you're a car coming? Accident.
I found a site here that talks about country music, and it just lists a couple of Trace's injuries.
Yeah.
This one says here, in 1982, a bulldozer accident resulted in deep cuts to Trace's hindquarters. He thought he was fixing to lose both his legs.
Fixing.
It has a quote wow. saying from
his
him.
Legs, yeah.
Yes.
And then he was in an oil tank explosion in 1983.
This guy's
while he was trying to repair a leak, crushing his left leg.
Damn!
What was Penn thinking?
This guy's the Terminator.
Oh no, on Twitter it's coming in.
Yeah.
Little known fact, Trace Adkins donated both kidneys to a kitten with leukemia.
What a guy.
I added, his brother died when he was 21, so Trace dedicated his first album to him.
Yeah.
What was that song you were singing that I really liked?
Honky Tonk Badonka Donk?
No!
Say a Prayer for Peace.
I can't find that on iTunes.
Two people were killed in a collision with his tour bus. Oh, my God. And then he was in an accident as a teenager.
What? Come on! This guy's just all tragedy.
Let's say hi to Jason in Detroit. Are you just fucking with us?
No, I actually looked it up on Wikipedia, so I do want to take that as a source.
Okay.
He was driving his 1955 pickup truck as a teenager, and he hit a bus head-on, broke both his legs and his arm.
He survives a head-on collision with a bus?
They really... God wants those legs of his, but he ain't giving them up that easy.
No, he's not. Should we go to Wikipedia before we finalize the list? Or yes, Erik.
When you were talking about his finger being cut... I'm trying to remember. Did you explain what he was doing and how he did it?
No, I don't think so.
All right. This says in 1989, he nearly cut off his finger trying to open a can of pipe dope with a 6-inch buck knife.
Oh, ow.
Wow.
Wow. Oh, that'll hurt.
Is that what somebody says when they want you to hand them a pipe?
Pipe. Oh, my God.
Oh, do you have the Penn Jillette list all set?
Just trying to help.
Yeah, I have the Penn Jillette list.
All right, you guys ready for the Penn Jillette list?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, enough about Trace Adkins. All right, the Penn Jillette list.
Here's the Penn Jillette list.
Okay.
His parents are dead. He might be a Jew.
Ah.
That's all we know.
That's all we really know about why he would, you know, get votes. Or
of course he would put sea salt in his ice cream.
He better.
He was desperate. He was real desperate. Yeah. And Trace knows he has it, so he's like throwing a bone to Maple.
Yeah. He's like, there's not enough macadamia nut awareness.
He knows
right.
People don't fucking give a shit about Maple. He's trying to help out the Maple people.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm helping the Maple industry.
Right. Because I already know I got this in the bag.
Hi, I'm Trace Adkins for the American Maple Association.
Yeah. Let's play some Trace Adkins into break. You want to play the one we started? Someone is saying we should play Arlington.
We'll do Honky Tonk Badonkadonk.
No!
Honky Tonk Badonkadonk. I don't know what that means.
It's a honky tonk badonkadonk.
Wait.
You like that?
No.
It's terrible.
Bruce has something on Penn Jillette.
Hi, Bruce.
Oh,
Bruce.
I mean, we got to be fair. We're trying to build the Penn Jillette list. Yes, Bruce.
Hey, boys.
Hey.
Calling from the highway in Maryland.
Good for you.
And Jesus, I got something on Penn Jillette's side of the list.
Yeah.
Well, a few years ago on a television show, they did a walkthrough of Penn Jillette's home, and he's got his own personal sex dungeon.
Oh, God.
You know what? Add it to the list, Sam. You never know what America's
good,
into.
Trace's house burned down.
That's not good.
And Penn has a sex dungeon.
Middle America will not appreciate.
He plays in a jazz trio.
Oh, jazz.
God, I know. That's right. He does.
Before he shows.
He plays the stand-up
He warms
bass,
up his
right?
own fucking show with a three-piece.
Yep.
Let's say hi to Ron in Wisconsin. Ron.
Yeah, you need to listen to the song Arlington. It's a real support for the troops and tearjerker. Check that out.
Like a good dick jerker.
Should we go with Arlington or the one we were playing?
Let's try Arlington. No, not that one, Sam.
Let's try Arlington going into break. Fuck it. You got that, E-Rock?
Yeah, I have that one.
Do you want me to give you the updated Penn Jillette list?
Yes, please, Sam.
He might be a Jew. Mm-hmm. His parents are dead. Mm-hmm. He has a sex dungeon.
Yes.
He's sunk. He is so sunk.
Where can we bet on this? This is an easy win.
Yeah.
He might be a Jew.
He might be a Jew.
And I believe we're friends with Penn Jillette, officially.
Oh, very good friends.
But we have to bet against him.
He was very nice to my sister, Dawnie.
And he remembered.
Yes. We want Penn Jillette to win.
We do, but
we're just looking
it's
at the facts.
Happening.
You know, the one thing we got to add to the Penn Jillette list that certainly is not going to help him.
Why?
He's an outspoken atheist.
Yeah.
Oh,
he thinks God's a queer.
God.
He's so done.
Trace Adkins is all about, you know,
God and country.
And here's an atheist with a sex dungeon. God damn it.
And I don't think nail polish, whatever as sweet as the reason may be, is going to help him.
He wears nail polish on his pinky.
Well, that's not going
to
help him.
Let's add that to the list.
Ring finger. Which finger is it?
Ring finger.
That's
and
for,
most people don't
that's
know
for his mom, though. That's a cool
but
thing.
But people don't
know
that.
They don't
people
know
don't
that.
Know it.
They just see some fruity Jew with a fucking...
Yeah, sex dungeon who hates
up like
God.
A girl.
A 6'8" Jew with a nail polish on one finger.
I don't even know what Penn is. I assume
he's Jew, obviously.
Is he Jewish? I don't know if he's Jewish.
No, he's atheist. He couldn't be Jewish.
But, yeah, I don't know what he was born.
I forgot.
I'm quite sure he was not born Jewish.
Might be a Jew.
Should we change it to might be a Jew, just to be fair?
No, that's what the list is. He might be a Jew.
Okay. Might be.
This is what the American public sees.
Yes, yes.
And the American public is thinking that he's probably a Jew.
Probably.
All right, let's do the final list.
Okay.
Go with Trace Adkins first.
Trace Adkins.
Uh-huh.
He was shot in the heart, but he didn't press charges against his ex-wife who shot him.
Does anyone else understand how fucking cool that is?
That's crazy. Yeah.
His house burned down.
Right.
But his kids survived because they had a fire plan.
Yeah.
He helps the Wounded Warrior Project.
Mm-hmm.
He sells bulldozers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's American.
His finger's been amputated, but he keeps trying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He has a wonderful voice.
He does.
He's selling ice cream for the American Red Cross.
That's nice.
He used to be an oil rig worker.
Mm-hmm. Don't forget about the explosion.
He gave. Oh, what was.
Surviving
in 1983.
Yeah. He survived an oil tank explosion while trying to repair a leak.
Don't forget to put that in.
Yep. Well, who survives an oil
tank? And how did he hurt his finger, Iraq?
I don't know. We'll have to listen later. Okay, I have something for Penn's list.
You have something for Penn's list.
Penn doesn't drink. He's not a beer drinker.
That's not good.
America respects that, right?
Love a good drinker.
Holy fuck.
Okay, he used to be an oil rig worker. He survived an oil rig explosion in 1983. He gave money given to him for a new house to charity.
Right.
He has billionaire friends.
Right.
He's not afraid to have a little fun.
Right.
And his brother died when his brother was 21. Oh, and so Trace dedicated his first album to him.
You forgot about the head-on collision with a bus.
Head-on collision.
As a teenager.
With a bus, as a teen.
Come on.
And what about the thing with his legs?
I thought some of that stuff started to get undocumented.
The bulldozer almost taking his ass cheeks off?
Right.
Right. Yeah, it was his ass cheeks, officially, right?
Yeah, unofficially, because I don't think we have any proof.
But I will add that when he was a teen, he was in a head-on collision with a bus.
Yeah.
Oh, no, here, fact coming in.
Yeah.
Trace Adkins is actually the Navy SEAL who killed Bin Laden.
Oh man.
Shit.
Who knew that?
All right, and then do you want to hear the Penn final list?
Yes, please.
Okay, the final list for Penn. He might be a Jew. His parents are dead. He has a sex dungeon. And he's an outspoken atheist who wears nail polish.
Oh, God.
The country is not going to take
no. Jesus. Middle America does not relate to this.
No.
Hold on. I am trying to move on here, but there's an actual website.
Oh.
Just more. Yeah, it's real. Okay. 13 country artists with bad luck, and one of them is Trace Adkins.
Oh. He's 1 through 9.
It's on a website called tasteofcountry.com, and then you'll get to the Trace Adkins, I guess. I want to thank Quick RNU on Twitter for sending us this.
There it is. What does it say?
All right. So we have there might be some more nuggets in here.
There actually are a couple more nuggets.
Okay.
Trace Adkins has been shot by his wife.
Okay.
He had his pinky finger cut off.
Yeah.
Had his nose ripped off in a car accident. It was sewn back on.
We didn't hear about that.
Had his house burned down.
His nose was ripped off?
Yeah.
Woo-hoo.
And been involved...
So was mine by Pinocchio, Robin. Get it? I have a big nose.
Yeah. And been involved in multiple tractor accidents.
Multiple. Who gets in one tractor accident?
Who gets back in a tractor after being in a tractor accident?
Okay, I gotta add the nose thing.
Yeah, his nose was ripped off.
You don't leave out having your nose ripped off.
How do you keep a fish from smelling?
How?
Cut off his nose.
It's not funny, Chip. It's a terrible old joke that children tell.
Let's play Arlington and it's a break. It's about the Arlington Cemetery by Trace Atkins.
Not a good joke.
No.
I think we made our point here today.
Yeah. Trace Atkins sings songs about the Arlington Cemetery.
Right.
Yeah. And Penn Jillette does the bullet trick.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, but the bullet trick is very impressive.
It's impressive.
It is impressive.
It's not exactly a tearjerker.
Trace Adkins never fucking took a picture of my sister.
He had his nose ripped off.
True.
Is it true Penn was in a Run DMC video? That's not bad.
Uh-oh. Yeah, the middle of America doesn't like that. Interaction with the blacks.
Oh, yeah. Fucking Chip. What a downer Chip is.
Oh my God. Penn's creepy. I didn't know this about Penn. Rick in El Paso. Rick.
Hey, Rick.
Yeah. Hey. Yeah, Penn actually owns a piece of flesh with a tattoo on it that was taken from the cadaver of a murderer after his execution.
What? Jesus.
He's got a piece of flesh that has a tattoo on it from a murderer after his execution. It was basically filleted off him and put in a frame.
Why did he want that?
Get that?
Well, it's fucking Penn Jillette. Come on. He's a freaky dude.
But was it a famous murderer?
I'm not sure. During the interview, he wasn't even sure he was supposed to have it.
but he's, you know, he said, look what I got.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like something you should be allowed to have.
Right. But all right, we could add it to the list, though, that's for sure.
Wow, that's not good for him.
Yes. I even know the case of the killer, actually. It was a murderer.
Too far over here.
No. But it was a very famous serial killer.
Yeah. Who was it?
His name was the Jocularity Killer. He would laugh.
OJ.
Killed his victims.
All right, we're done. Trace Adkins, not done with the show, done with this, I guess.
Yeah. Good luck to you.
I hope people vote for Penn Jillette, but
there's no voting.
Oh yeah, that's true.
Just buy his fucking ice cream. He needs all the help he can get. Yeah, he's got a sex dungeon.
True.
Yeah, me too.
Opie and Anthony's worst of 2013. On the Opie and Anthony channel.
Trace Adkins.
Here comes the Magnolia Bakery treats.
Those are delicious.
Yes.
That's not Trace Adkins.
No. Is that the wife that shot him?
That looks like a panda.
Should we not bring that up?
Oh, God damn.
Yeah, right.
Hi, I'm Trace Adkins.
There he is. Trace Adkins. Take a seat over here. Pull up a mic. We're on the air live. There we just do this. Like, look at that. There's the voice.
They told me y'all were, so.
Oh, yeah?
Goddamn, Trace Adkins. Let me tell you something. We're really good.
Big mitts on him, too.
I know. Do you know Colin Quinn?
Stop holding my hand, Quinn. How you doing? Good to see you. Back in the day.
Yeah. You guys know each other?
Trace? No.
Oh, okay. No, but I'm a fan. So.
You're a fan of Colin Quinn? And Tom Papa to your right.
Hey, Trace.
He's good. He's good friends with Jerry Seinfeld. That's his claim. No, I mean,
he's acting with Michael Douglas in a new movie.
In that
The Liberace movie.
The Liberace movie.
Really?
I'll brag for my pal Tom Papa.
So,
thank you. Do you think Trace or any of his buddies down there are going to go see that Liberace movie?
Hell no. Hell's no.
I'm probably not.
Trace, we had a Penn Jillette in here yesterday.
Oh, yeah?
And he was pitching his ice cream. Yeah. You know, Apprentice, a celebrity all-star, friggin' amazing Apprentice this season.
Yeah.
You guys are head-to-head now.
Yeah,
so much. Now the object is to sell this ice cream.
Yes.
At this point.
Right.
How do you feel you're doing?
I'm doing great. I got a little pint of Penn's ice cream yesterday. I found a booger right on the top.
Oh,
the booger.
Shit.
There's a booger right on the top.
Oh, shit.
There's a booger on the top of it. So his ice cream has boogers in it, I'm just telling you.
That could be detrimental to ice cream sales.
At least I tried to disguise mine with macadamia nuts.
So if something falls in there during production, people think it's a macadamia.
Right.
I got you. Good strategy.
But his just has boogers.
But we got to explain to Trace. We're really good friends with Penn Jillette. He does the show a lot. But then we kind of started looking into your history, and we're all in. We're hoping you win
this
thing.
Penn is sunk.
Because your backstory is way better than Penn Jillette's.
Absolutely. Well. As far as country artists go, you fit that bill that everyone has stereotyped over the years of taking tragedy and turning it around, making pulling yourself up by the proverbial bootstraps, as they say.
Well, I suppose so. That's why I think I've written one positive love song in my life, and I was commissioned to write that one. And I think that's about it.
You came up as a working guy. You know, you worked in real.
I worked in oil field for 10 years.
Oil field.
I worked offshore on a drilling rig for 6 years. Roughneck, worked derricks.
Jesus.
Wow.
Yeah. So
that's a real
job.
That's how
I cut my finger off.
Yeah. Apparently, we read you cut your finger off.
Yeah, I cut that one off.
It was then
right off.
It's permanently at 90 degrees.
They put it back on, but it's bent like that. The doctor asked me, he said, it's not going to work anymore. I think I can save it, but how do you want it? You want it straight? And I said, no. I said, put it in a sus position.
So now you can play.
And I said, at least I can suspend a D or a G, you know.
Oh, man.
And I said, put it in a sus position. He went, excuse me? I showed him with my other hand. I said, do it like that.
That's so, having some forethought.
Wow.
Well, not really, because, I mean, the second that I cut it, that was the first thing I thought. Well, there goes my guitar playing. You know, I
Holy
knew
shit,
it was pretty
yes.
much over at that point.
Wow.
There's no way he's seeing Liberace.
No. No, he's not.
But wait, you worked in those oil rigs that go off the coast and stuff?
Yeah.
Wow.
That's where the offshore ones are, Colin.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Oh, no, I hung out to dry there. I'm sorry, Colin. I told Colin I'd be nice to him when another guest was in.
To dry. And by the way, as Bobby Kelly pointed out to me, it was always funny to me when it was Voss or Bobby Kelly. Then it was me. Then I was like, oh, this is not funny at all.
Right. That's true.
Man, that thing you and Seinfeld did a while back was brilliant.
Oh, thanks.
That Damn. Was absolutely brilliant.
The one-man show?
That was brilliant.
He's got a new one that we saw last night. That was great.
Great.
I'll bust it out.
That's great.
I'm all over it. I'm in.
He does do a great thing.
Barrow Street Theater.
What are your, I could probably guess, but your political affiliations as far as that, things that are going on in the news these days, the what I say is the dismantling of the Constitution. Do you get involved in much of that?
Well, I don't get involved in it. You know, I don't, and people know that too. They come to my shows and they're not going to get beat over the head with anything.
That's good.
I don't do that. I never have. I don't like people that do. Mm-hmm. But at least, you know, some of the ones that do it, they're right up front with it. And you know that going in that you're going to get that. I don't like to be ambushed by somebody.
Right, right, right.
But anyway, I'm a pretty conservative guy, sure. You know, and what's going on right now, you know, I believe that when the government starts using agencies to persecute people that they have political and philosophical differences with, that's tyranny, my friend.
Thank you. Absolutely. God damn, I got a great... And with that fucking voice saying it like that?
Yep.
That means business.
It makes you believe.
I agree.
No kidding.
God, it's so nice. It's so refreshing to see somebody in the business that we call show.
Right.
Well, I'm sure you heard something similar to that from Penn yesterday.
Well, yeah, a little bit. Penn, again, also doesn't really put himself out there politically that much. Yeah, he is a libertarian.
He is a libertarian.
And an atheist.
He's sort of a libertarian.
Yeah.
He's a quasi-libertarian.
And
a libertarian is just a Republican that smokes dope.
That's true. That's really true.
Do you go shooting and stuff?
Yeah, if something needs shooting.
No, very good. Yeah. I enjoy a little gunfire. But I go to the range. You know, there's not much going on. Well, I do appreciate my Second Amendment right.
I've got a lot of guns. I got a lot of guns.
Yeah.
As many guns as he does.
I got a lot. It's very difficult in New York too.
Predator drones.
Well, I don't have a predator drone.
I want one of those.
He's got
I want a drone, man.
Well, no, I got a pretty big one with cameras on it and stuff. I could send it up autonomously to patrol the neighborhood.
Awesome. That's great.
I monitored some people getting a pizza delivery the other day. It was very exciting. Very compelling video I got from that one. But no, I really do. And in New York, it's very difficult, as you probably know, to even say that you own guns. But no, I love it. I picked up a Barrett 50 cal.
Man, they make those just right down the road from where I live in Murfreesboro, Tennessee.
Oh, isn't that fantastic?
Yeah.
You ever fire one of those? They're
I have.
A lot of fun.
I don't have one yet. I'm about to get one. Yeah. I just got a Desert Eagle 50 caliber.
I got one of those, too.
Oh,
those
wow.
What a treat. You take that down to the indoor range and
they
fire
won't,
it.
They won't. At my indoor range, they won't let me shoot it.
They won't?
No.
Over here in Nassau, they let me. But you watch everybody from all the other slots, they peek their head around like, what
right,
the
yeah.
Hell
somebody's got a cannon.
Is he firing?
What is it?
You know, when
it's a 50
exactly?
caliber pistol.
Yeah.
It's the Arnold Schwarzenegger one from that.
From
the guy that I got it from, you know, he said, dude, don't ever shoot anybody in your house with this.
It's not the most practical gun.
Wait till they go outside because it will make a mess.
It's not the most practical gun to have, but it is a lot of fun.
Yeah, I'm not worried about the killing. I'm worried about the cleanup.
Right. The mess. You shoot a melon with that thing, and it just
explodes.
Yeah. It's fantastic.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's fun to shoot.
Yeah, it is.
Is it heavy?
Very. You could, and you put a full magazine in there because the shells are really, really big.
Really big.
You could bludgeon. So you could do some damage with just beating someone.
Yeah, you don't have to shoot anybody.
You don't have to shoot the damn thing.
We got to ask you, man. Speaking of shooting, when we learned about you yesterday, you got shot in the heart.
Mm, yeah.
Jesus.
Holy fuck.
How'd that happen?
The stories are insane.
Really mad woman.
Wow. Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and she had the pistol, and it was I learned a very good life lesson from that. I held my hand out like this, and I said, "Give me that pistol, or I'm going to take it away from you and beat your goddamn brains out with it."
Oh!
And she stuck it under my arm and pulled the trigger.
The bullet
went in here and came out here.
Wow!
I mean, it went
straight across the chest cavity,
went through both of my lungs.
Did you think that
heart.
Was it? Because right in your chest.
You know, right when something like that happens, you just, you know, you don't think. You know, I just remember thinking that it was brand new Berber carpet, and I thought, if I bleed on this carpet, she's going to shoot me again. So
Christ.
I went to a room that had tile floor and laid down there to die.
It's amazing what you think.
Oh, my God. Wow.
How close were you to dying?
Huh?
How close were you?
I don't know. You know, they life flighted me to the trauma center at Vanderbilt University Medical Center. They saved my life.
Yeah.
It was. Had it not been for that trauma center there, I wouldn't be here.
Did she call 911?
She did. She did. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, she did.
That's
And he never pressed charges.
Well, I got a good clean divorce out of the deal.
Wow.
You know, now we understand.
After my divorce, I would rather have been shot, I think. It would have been less painful.
Now we understand.
Financially viable.
Because we're like, how do you not press charges? Well, he answered that question.
That is a good...
It was cheaper.
That's a good chip to bring into the courtroom with you.
Well,
oh, yeah, and by the way...
Right. Let's not forget.
Yeah.
Wow.
No, it didn't go to court.
Yeah.
Wow.
Wow, that is something.
You must have really pissed her off.
Yeah, I did. I really did.
Tom's taking her side. I love it. Said, hey, Trace,
no,
what'd you do?
Right.
Trace, how do you remiss if I said,
man,
just enjoy
my body is covered with scars, and I deserved every one of them.
Every one of them,
I'm
huh?
I'm not going to sit here and try to say anything.
An oil rig accident is rarely just, hey, someone got a Band-Aid over there. It usually ends up being pretty...
Yeah, I got a scar here. You know, I busted my ribs and, you know, my elbow. I've had to operate on that because Jack in the pipe and the derrick, you know, and wore my elbows out. And so, you know, I'm all used up, but, you know.
Was that good money at the time?
Yeah. Good money. Yeah. Better than what I make now.
Jesus.
I make hundreds of dollars a year now.
Fuck, man.
Oh, damn.
Were you playing music the whole time you were out there, or did that come up later?
No, yeah, I was... playing guitar and trying to write stuff when I was out there. Yeah, I started. My old man got me guitar when I was 10. I don't really know why he did it. He didn't play. So that's when I started.
Oh, wow.
And what was the big break there for that got you off the rig?
My second wife wanted to move far away from my first wife because they didn't get along at all.
Yeah.
So we moved, and she said, let's move. I can't stand her. And I was like, okay, well, I don't really like her that much either. Where you want to go? And I said, let's just go to Nashville. I said, you know, I like to sing and play, and maybe I can make something happen. So,
were you knocking around the clubs over there in Nashville?
Yeah, I played clubs there for about 3 years.
They got a lot of bars.
I was working construction and playing. You got to have a day gig in Nashville, right. too.
Yeah.
And you just kind of play clubs in the same way until someone notices. And
yeah, I played the club circuit in Texas for about 5 years. In Texas, the Southwest, Texas, New Mexico, you know, Oklahoma. I played that circuit for 5 years.
Did you enjoy
in
it?
In the late 80s.
Was it fun?
Yeah, I did. Yeah. I really did enjoy it. And it finally got to a point where I faced myself in the mirror one morning and said, you know what? 5 years ago, I wouldn't even have hung out with somebody like you because I'd gotten really strung out. And it was, you know, I had to get away from it, go back to the oil field to save my life.
Wow,
you know?
Really?
Wow.
Damn.
Too much partying.
That's some perspective.
That's what strung out means.
Yeah.
For you from the Liberace movie. So which one of you Nancy's doesn't like maple in my ice cream anyway?
Oh, boy. I don't know. Who said that? Sam, was that
somebody
you?
Somebody said.
Oh, Sam saying he doesn't like maple.
Yeah, I don't know who said that, Trace. That would be crazy to say in front of you.
We just assumed with everything you have going on in your life, you were probably head of the maple producers coalition or something.
Hey, let me write that down.
Yeah, write that down.
We're all big fans of maple, right, Ann?
Yeah.
We love
maple. This is where it starts. Now stop. Trace, you're an oil rig guy, a badass, a bar fighter. How the hell did you end up with maple macadamia mashup? We're putting a stop to it today.
Okay. Let me tell you where I'm at in my life right now, man.
Yes.
I have prostitutes coming up to me going, dude, the shit you're doing for money is just You know, how can you live with yourself? And I don't disagree. I have no pride anymore.
You know what, though?
I'm just like Quinn. We sold our dignity a long time ago. And I sold mine cheap. I don't know about him.
I got to say, though, the All-Star Apprentice ice cream here from Trace, the Maple Macadamia mashup, proceeds going to the Red Cross, the American Red Cross.
Right.
See, that's pretty goddamn good right there. Yeah. You can't totally say you sold out. And then also your Wounded Warrior Project work is amazing.
Well, that's been a privilege.
Absolutely, right?
You know, the association with them has just been just something that has just been a humbling experience for me. I've been doing that for a few years now, and just a great organization.
We hope you win Celebrity Apprentice.
I do, too.
you just told Penn that yesterday.
No, I don't even know. No, I said it after we looked at his backstory that we have to go with this guy. I did say that. I changed my opinion, even though he's a really good friend of ours. But how do you not root for a guy like this?
Penn's a really good friend of mine, too, man.
Yeah, but Penn has a sex dungeon. That's all he's got going for him.
How is the Midwest going to appreciate a magician with a sex dungeon?
Right. We're going all American with this one.
I wonder what bars they go to when you work in the oil rigs. Don't you guys have like a group of bars you go in and you get into a little flack with the local, you
Didn't
know,
you see Armageddon?
Crispy.
What's wrong with you?
No,
of course they do. You didn't see Armageddon?
No.
Bunch of roughnecks out there in space?
I don't like those kind of movies.
Did you watch that, Trace, and just go, get out of here. I could have done that. I could have done that.
No, it was one of the most ridiculous
Let's
movies.
Let's make a movie that will
We got Guy Fieri outside, too, so I don't know what to do.
Oh, Jesus.
I'll sit on the couch.
I saw him.
No.
I saw him the other day.
Oh, my God.
What are you guys doing? Sharon, Colin, you can't do that.
I'm sitting right here.
Hey, look, that's Fieri's manager. That's a big, look how big that is.
That is a big son of a bitch.
He might be taller than you, Trace.
He is tall. I met him yesterday. He's taller than me.
Here's Guy Fieri.
Rock and roll, AC/DC.
Yeah.
For those about to rock, right on his fucking chest, baby.
What's up, Guy?
Yeah. Good
to see you, buddy.
You know, Trace.
I just met him the other day. God, is he tall.
Yeah,
he's tall.
Your manager.
Yeah, your manager's pretty goddamn tall.
But he's
right
not
there.
Rocking a cowboy hat and boots.
Yeah,
he's in Nikes and a golf shirt.
Yeah.
No, I saw him. We met the other day, and what a great guy! And you hit the tour, man. You've been all over.
Well, you know, that's what they make you do when you have a new album come out. They make you go dance for granny.
The girls were going nuts at that show the other day.
I can imagine.
I'm like, hey, I'm here. I'm cooking. I'm making some food.
You were cooking at one of his shows.
I should have been cooking at one of the shows. It would have been, we were
doing one of the morning shows.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Had a good time. So we were standing out there grilling and talking about food and the whole thing. And he's from Louisiana.
Knives. We were talking about knives.
We were talking about knives.
He has this, you got to respect the guy that's got his own line of cutlery.
Yeah. We were just looking at that. Knuckle sandwich knives.
Yeah,
that's
crazy.
What a great name.
Flames on him. Big sharp blade.
Right, Kyle? Yeah. Great name for his knives.
Yes, indeed. Guy, do you remember we met Austin, Texas.
Really? Colin Quinn?
Colin makes a face like, nah.
You recognize me.
Austin, Texas.
He's so proud of himself that he remembered something.
He really is.
Did you see that look on his face?
That was awesome.
He had a senior moment. He's like, I remembered something.
Come on, I know exactly.
Senior moment. The Magnolia Bakery treats, Guy. CQ, who else?
Wait, nice.
You also switched spots with Tom Papa.
Yeah, I think Tom felt a little like, you know.
Tom should be on the couch. Quite frankly.
No, I was like, Colin Quinn is to be up here. But Guy and I go way back also.
I want an expert opinion.
Tom, will you
try some
get
of that
up
ice cream?
Here, man.
I don't care if y'all try it. I want him to try it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, Guy, try the maple.
He's the expert.
What is this called? Moonshine mashup? See, I tell you, if there would have been a little moonshine in this, I think these are great.
Well, we know.
Yo, the Mad Cuban's in here, too.
No, you're not calling
the Mad Cuban.
We love him.
It's crazy.
You were the one who introduced us to him, and now he does our show.
Maple-y. It has a butterscotchy taste to it.
It's very good.
That is good. It's pretty good.
Yeah. I know.
Hope you should try something.
Shut the front door.
What's all guys?
You know, and I just thought, you know, Penn, he did, he went way out there and mixed vanilla and chocolate.
I did
a maple macadamia, which my young lady, they called her an ice cream wizard. She said that, as far as she knew, that hadn't been done. So.
Mm. I'll tell you, I had Penn's yesterday, and he's got salt in his. He's got a sea salt.
Got a little sea salt in it.
Which salt and the counterbalance to the sugar, I mean, it really plays nicely. And he had big chunks of chocolate in it, kind of a bittersweet chocolate. But I'm not a huge chocolate guy.
Oh.
This right here reminds me of like pralines and cream. That macadamia nut survives in there. A lot of times the nuts kind of get, you know, they kind of get crushed and they're a little soft and they don't have any texture. This has great texture. It's not overly sweet. You think maple and I'm like, oh boy, someone's going to go crazy with the Mrs. Butterworth. But this got a good balance, man.
She kept coming to me and I would say, come on, give me some more maple. And she kept cranking up the maple intensity. I thought I may have gone a little too far with it. You think it's all right? It's almost too much.
Can you ship this to people's houses? I mean, or can you only buy Dwayne Reed
and Walgreens?
Walgreens.
Is it only in New York they carry it?
No, it's everywhere.
Everywhere.
I'm nationwide, dude.
National, right?
Nationwide.
Hell yeah.
Nationwide.
God damn, is that a great song?
Tell us about the new album that's coming out.
I got a new album out. Called Love Will, and it's just nothing but love songs. I've never done that before. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Love Will, dot, dot, dot. Huh? There you go. Thank you, guy. Yeah, right there, man.
Guy knows.
Wait, did you do that?
The first time I'd ever done that.
We just started playing your songs yesterday. And
I didn't set out to do it, really. I thought I had the album done in August, and then this Apprentice thing came up, and I whored out and went and did that. so I couldn't come out in the fall with the album like I thought I was going to, so we had to delay the release of it. And in the meantime, I came up with a few more songs, and I recorded them, and then I realized that I had 11 love songs. I had about 18, 19 songs cut, and I thought, wow, 11 of these are love songs, so I'm just going to put out an album of love songs. But it's not like a bread album. I mean, don't think that it's that. Because you got to keep in mind, I'm the guy that thinks Badonka Donk is a love song.
Right,
so,
yes.
You know, But I will say this album is a deal closer. You know, if you've got, and she's not cooperating and spend an evening with her, put this album on, close
the
deal.
Sounds like Fast Times at Ridgemont.
Or let her go.
Yeah.
Must have been somebody's baby.
Yeah. Oh.
Jennifer Jason Leigh's getting plowed again.
Every time that goddamn song
came
out.
In the
dugout.
So did anything change in your life where you're like, I love songs, let me jot a few of these down? Or
no, you know, I don't, not consciously. But maybe there's something going on. You know, I think I don't want to get all into that stuff, man. But I suppose there's a time in a man's life when he starts staring mortality in the face, and you know, and you start realizing.
What was that for you? Like 10, based on your bio? Holy shit!
No, I always thought I was indestructible. Now I kind of know that I'm not. So
yeah, that kind of sucks.
Getting shot in the heart does that to a man.
Yeah, man. Who said that? Oh, the couch.
Oh, my Tom.
Poor Tom. I can't even see him.
He's at the kid table.
I couldn't stand to see Colin Quinn after watching his show last night sitting on the couch.
I couldn't stand to see Colin.
I can't have the legend be on the couch.
Tom, you should have seen when Mark Cuban and Bill Burr was in here. I was sitting on that couch. It was ridiculous.
You were just being pounded. That was terrible. And
now you're just name dropping Mark Cuban. Wow.
If I had a fucking Desert Eagle that day, there'd be no Mark Cuban.
Damn.
Opie or Bill Burr.
And of course, Guy Fieri, you have a book with like the longest title ever. What is that?
Listen,
do I have to read all the signs?
No, don't read all the signs.
Oh, it's New York Times best-selling author Guy Fieri.
Just leave it at that.
That's the first sign. Then it goes to the next one.
Diners, Drive-Ins, Dives, The Funky Finds in Flavor Town, America's Classic Joints, and Killer Comfort Food includes behind-the-scenes stories and jocularities from the Triple D crew and restaurant owners.
Cut me, Mick. Cut me.
Wow. Cut me, Mick. Next time, I swear.
That is...
Listen, I don't know about these publishers.
Just put it in a search
engine. Publishers, yeah, exactly. That's exactly what it is. Get every tagline, every phrase you can. What might be associated with it?
But another book, Guy. Man.
I'll tell you what it is.
How many is this?
This is my fourth book, but my third Diners book. And we've done like 600 locations on Triple D. And so people ask, like, you know, well, how do we find the places and get us a map and do this? So we just eventually, I mean, this is like 2 years later for the third book. So
so you could literally take a little trip, a little road trip, and stop in at some of these joints?
In the back of it, it gives you the address and the website and all the, you know.
Nice.
We have people that are traveling. I mean, I run into folks when I'm out there doing the show that have done like 300, 400 locations.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, what are you?
Wow.
I mean, they've got like RVs. They're doing more locations than I am. And then they're bringing me portfolios of other places I should try. I'm like, no, get out of the wave. I mean, just let me go at my own.
Hey, you know what we're doing this fall? We're taking a bus trip, a tour bus from here, from New York, down to where we ended up.
Branson, Missouri,
but
Nashville.
We're going through Branson.
That's
because
right.
Because we have to check out, even though I think Yonko's not going to be there. But check out the Barry Williams 70s song explosion extravaganza.
It's a long story.
Was there a Yakov Smirnoff reference in there?
I think Yakov.
Well, that's why we're going.
Seriously, did I just hear Yakov Smirnoff?
Yakov.
That's why we're going. He's
I saw
got a
him in Vegas when I was in college.
Trace is just shaking his head.
So you want
hey,
Trace,
Guy, I
want
to ask you something.
Yes, sir.
You know, the magazine's on airplanes, and they've got the list of the 10 best steakhouses in America.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
okay.
I know.
But those people pay. Do these people pay you to be in this book?
Ooh. No, but geez, you started getting WWF on me. You started pushing me. Let me ask you a question.
Listen to me, brother.
I'm going to break it down.
Brother.
No. Did you see how he turned?
Yes.
Yes. Maybe. I don't think.
I kind of like seeing somebody fucking alpha male in your ass.
I'm telling you,
saw me start to serve the ice cream right in his face. He's like, let me ask you something.
Yeah.
Hey. Suspended.
He turned around.
Sus right in your
man,
face.
I'll sus you. I'll hook that. Sus, I hook this sus in your nose, and you're in deep trouble, my friend.
No, we don't take any.
I'll sus hook you, man.
We don't take any bribes, as far as
that's
you know.
That's some new good shit, Quinn. I never even thought of that. I'm gonna sus hook you, boy.
All I know is he's got his pinky curled up like he's gonna gaff somebody in the nose with it. I might have missed that piece.
Yeah,
we're going with Trace to win Celebrity Apprentice.
I might have to.
And Penn Jillette's a friend of ours.
I don't know, boy. We are really
tell me about this road trip, by the way. I want to hear about this.
I know. We're just jumping on a bus,
so we're gonna be stopping at a few places. You know, anywhere where's a good place along the way? Give us an example.
Set up. You guys just give me the itinerary. I will set up the feeding zones, and we'll weigh you at the beginning of the event,
like McCluskey,
and then we'll weigh
with
you at Branson. we'll put three of those Branson, Missouri buffets under your belt.
Nice.
Oh,
you know, I hear Yakov's place. Yakov's dinner adventure. What happens is he gives you a real metal tray that has a magnet on the back, and it sticks on the seat because when you watch Yakov's dinner theater. It's in movie theater seats. You're literally sitting in movie theater seats. So they have magnets on the arm. You click your metal tray, but don't get discouraged. Genuine linen napkins, real silverware.
No, you get a spork. I know you get a spork.
No,
with that
real.
Nope.
This is what they actually pitch.
They're
on
advertising
the website,
this shit.
That they have real linen napkins, real silverware, and a chicken cordon bleu.
Ooh.
Which I'm sure is just being pumped out of there like the chocolate on that Lucy conveyor belt.
Yeah. They're going old school with that.
Yeah.
Cherry's Jubilee.
Cherry's Jubilee.
Right.
I went to Baked Alaska.
We're very excited about that.
So how long will the trip take?
A week.
About a week. We're just going to
do Memphis.
Fly back.
Nashville.
Oh, we got some
Austin.
Good. I got some good
food. We're going to Austin.
I got great Austin, great food. Memphis, great food.
Yeah.
Nashville, great food. I got a barbecue joint right outside of Nashville.
Can we just walk in and go, Kyle Fieri sent us
rock and roll.
Ooh. Yeah. And we're going to try to set it up to that degree.
Like cakes and shit.
No, I'm not. This will be good stuff. How many people in your crew? And what's your posse going to look like?
Man.
Like Winnipeg. Is this going to be like rubber
not,
ducky
not
convoy?
Not including the broads that we're going to get on the bus. The broads. Oh, boy. Yeah, sure.
You know they're
asleep by
their
fucking 9:30 at night.
The posse didn't look like. You ever see that scene? They stopped at the gas station and one flew over the cuckoo's nest.
That's
about right.
Is it going to look like convoy? You know, with all these dilapidated rigs behind you.
Yeah. It's going to be pretty shitty.
People flashing you when they drive by in the bus.
I'm hoping to get maybe a couple of CBs so we could talk to each other.
That'd be nice.
Ooh,
yeah.
CBs would be a nice touch.
Yeah. Yeah, buddy, I was the wrangler.
Are you going to bring the hardware?
That's right. What?
You going to bring the hardware?
I don't think I could bring my piece.
Why not?
You cross state lines. Everything's fucked up.
It's not Smokey and the Bandit.
You can't do that.
I had one on the bus one time I forgot about.
Oh,
it was in my nightstand by my bed, and then we crossed the border going into Canada, and they put me in jail.
Oh, they did lock you up?
Yeah, they locked me up for 6 hours. You know, they locked me up for about 6 hours.
Shouldn't they
How
know?
Do they come on and handcuff you is what I want to know.
No shit.
Well,
what
just,
job
is
that? Get on there and get him.
Right. No, I copped to it immediately because it was like border crossing trainee day, and so they were just like going through everything.
Oh, man.
So I immediately said, okay, wait, I forgot about something, and then I told them where it was, and then they just...
Hut, 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 hut.
Shouldn't they take things like that into consideration and know that it's like, look, It's Trace Adkins. He's not going to fucking be blasting off in Canada with this gun. It was an honest mistake, you know, as opposed to somebody you know is trying to commit some kind of real crime now. Right.
It was weird. And then when they gave me my pistol, it was a little 380 automatic. It wasn't a big deal. But they handed it back to me, and they had completely disassembled it. So it was just all in pieces. Shit.
Kept souvenir
parts. I had to walk back across the border and mail it home. They wouldn't let me drive back across.
Wow.
Wow.
So now do you have a weapons charge on you in Canada or something?
No, but that's why they really got mad, because I had a weapons charge here. And
Oh, boy.
I like the fact that every question Trace answers is like another story.
Really? This leads to another whole story.
Pandora's box. Just
yeah.
I love it, man.
We were shipping the Camaro we used for Triple D across the border, and I'd just been at a Kid Rock's place doing a shoot for
Triple D. God.
And we loaded it up.
Uh-oh.
You don't like the beer, or you don't like rock?
They found guns and dope and women in the trunk of the car.
So we loaded up. He makes this great beer, and we had it on the show, and I wanted to take some back to California, so I threw it in the trunk of my Camaro. Well, I just happened to forget the Camaro was on its way to Canada, so I get a call from this driver stressing out. There's beer in the back of your car. Where the hell did that come from?
Yeah, I don't know.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
But they let it go. They let the car come into Canada, cruise around with the 10 cases, and cruise back out.
Nice. Oh, okay. Did they know it was
no weapons charge.
No weapons. You got to watch that. I hate the fact that, you know, you go from one state to another, and your gun's good here. It's not good here. You're responsible, and we trust you, and you went through all the hoops here. Like in New York, you got to go through so much. I should be able to cover every goddamn state in the union. But, I can't drive across Jersey unless it's in a locked box, separate from the ammo. You're not stopping until you get to Pennsylvania, you know, shit like that, which is really stupid, because then if someone steals the car, instead of the gun being on you where you have possession of it and know where it is and it's not going to get in anyone else's hands, now someone's got your gun and your car. The laws make no sense. They punish the law-abiding citizen, do nothing to make anyone safer.
Where is this coming from? I've never heard you talk like this before.
Exactly, Paul. Do you know a New Yorker just got arrested? A New Yorker just got arrested because of the new law that only allows 7 rounds in your magazine. He had 10, because he had a 10-round mag.
Right, right, right.
And he got pulled over. He had the pistol on his seat, a statey, pulled him over, and saw the gun. The guy says, yes, I'm completely legal. I got this. The trooper checked the magazine, found that there were, you know, 3 more too many bullets, or 2. Right, I think it was a 9-round mag that he had, so it was only 2 extra bullets, and arrested him. And now the guy's got a weapons charge on him because of that. How did that make anyone any safer? How did that law just make New York a safer place to live because a guy that legally owns a gun, has all the permit, had 2 bullets too many in his magazine? The laws are ridiculous.
Talk to your boy Cuomo.
Yeah, well, he's one of
you know, the gun charge I had was a similar kind of thing. I wasn't doing anything illegal. I had a pistol, and it was in the pocket of the door of my truck.
Uh-huh.
And at the time, I didn't have a carry permit. Uh-oh. But anyway, so the pistol was there in the door, and it was loaded, of course. And I got pulled over for something else, and the guy looks and he goes, "Is that gun loaded?" And I said, "Is your gun loaded?" "Yeah, it's loaded." You know,
I carry it as a paperweight.
They're two useless things in this world: a dull knife and an empty gun. You know,
love it.
So he said, "Assume the position," and took me directly to jail. Wow. But that's my gun charge. I mean, I didn't like
it. What state was that?
That was Tennessee.
Tennessee. Wow.
I think now I have a carry permit. Tennessee. Yeah.
Tennessee. You know,
so they're all cool with it.
If you hook up like fucking Ted Nugent, they like deputize him, and he could carry anywhere in the country.
A bazooka.
You got to get that.
I like the fact that Trace doesn't think he's going to get arrested. He's like, "Hey, officer, there's 2 useless things in this world: a dull knife and an unloaded gun." Instead of going, "It's all loaded, right, sir, but
you're
I'm
free
on
to
my
go.
Way." "What did you tell him? Hey, fuck you. You're not going to do nothing about it." "It's loaded."
He asked me. He says, "Is that gun loaded, sir?" And I said, "Hell, is your gun loaded?" You know, I mean, come on, man. Yes, loaded.
Absolutely.
God.
Why wouldn't you have
six,
it loaded?
Six steps out of the
what,
truck.
What, I look like I'm in a Liberace movie?
I got caught stealing bubble yum once. And they put me in the back. My dad had to come get me.
Wow, that is frightening.
Hard time.
Trace has lived the life here, man. The work ethic, the getting hurt on a real man's job.
Right.
The country music star. weapons all charges. Jesus Christ. It's fantastic.
How are we going to tell Penn Jillette that we're not rooting for him anymore?
I know.
Should we call him? Told him.
I'm all in with Trace now. And, yeah. And this is fantastic.
Yeah, look, Ant's trying the ice cream.
Now it's a little mushy.
See, it's wonderful.
Oh, okay.
We probably should take a break.
You know what?
Get Trace.
I got to go anyway.
This should be good on waffles. This would be great on waffles.
I got to go to Atlantic City and hang out with my peeps.
Atlantic City? Where do you stay when you go there?
I don't stay anywhere there. I go there and
in and out.
I go there and they give me money and I leave.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I got to go do a show tonight at Caesars there.
Caesars in AC.
Can we play one of your new songs?
That'd be cool.
I didn't come over here just to talk to
you. No, we're going
to
do it, though.
He throws a smackdown. No matter what he says, you're that close from getting punched in the face.
He is a very intimidating guy.
Authentic.
Say no to a woman or watch the world end.
Say no to a woman.
All right, we're going
to
do that for
Watch the World Ends, a really sappy love song I did with Colby Calais. Yeah. It's beautiful, but it's not good for this show.
Beautiful is good for this show.
I don't know if any of the songs on this album are good for this show. You should go back and do something off one of my other albums. Whoop a man's ass or something like that.
We played Arlington yesterday.
Oh, did you?
That's a tearjerker. Yeah, what the fuck? Yeah.
A lot of people commented that they were bawling.
Yeah, that's a tearjerker, that song. And we played another one. What was the other one yesterday?
Honky Tonk Badonky Donk.
No, we played that. But
of course.
Well, that's a love song. That's pretty sensitive.
Of course it is. Yes.
I mean, especially when the moneymaker line comes by.
You know, it really
brings a tear.
Yeah. Yeah. What was the third one we played?
As a father of five daughters, that one really.
Oh, shit.
You got five daughters?
Yeah.
Wow.
Good luck with that.
You know, I've had people say, man, why you have five daughters? Because I wanted to have one son. And after the fifth one, I didn't even leave the hospital. I just walked down there. I said, dude,
just
you got
it.
To do something about this, man.
That's it, huh?
That was it.
Man.
Wow.
How old are they? How old are the girls?
28, 24, 15, 11, and 8.
All right, so you've had to deal with guys coming
all
over the
of
house.
Yeah,
how does that for a dad?
I never had a problem with it. Some of my likes.
Of course, you're 6'4". Yeah.
Hello. Yeah. Man, that would suck.
What
man,
part?
You meet a girl, you're liking her and stuff, and it's like, oh, let me introduce you to my dad. Oh, you know, who's... Oh, yeah, by the way, my dad's Trace Adkins. You're like, oh, my God, he's
giant. He doesn't put
up
with shit.
Yeah. He wants to wrestle you in the backyard.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Just don't fucking
all right, we gotta get
stay away from
here.
His pinky. Yeah. He'll put it in your nose.
Don't let him sus hook you.
Sus hook. Oh my God, King, he's going for the sus hook.
That's going to be my wrestling go-to move, man. I'm going to do some WWE, man.
There it is.
Yeah, there you go.
Go to the sus hook.
Trace, thanks so much for coming
Absolutely.
In.
Absolutely.
What a pleasure,
man. It's a pleasure
man.
To meet you guys.
It's a lot of fun.
I've been a fan for a long time.
It's great, man.
Thanks, man.
Colin, Quinn, wow.
Colin.
Thank you.
Liberace.
Liberace in the corner. There. Tom guy Papa. Got you.
O&A's Worst of 2013. Worst of 2013.
Celebrity Apprentice. We haven't talked to you since.
I know, and how the fuck
do you lose to that guy?
Well, first of all, I tell you, have Trace on. He's a good guy. You'll have a good time. Didn't I tell you that?
Yes, we ended up did. Really liking him.
Right, but totally like him to the point.
We blew you off.
I go to that show, my show that night, and they go, I thought O&A liked you. And I go, yeah, we get along great. What was it? They go, well, they're telling Trace he's going to win and fuck you. And they're, I go, what? And they said, I said, they didn't say his ice cream was better.
No.
Well, they said, they didn't say it was worse. I said, what's wrong with them? Fuckers, how long have I been your friend?
I know.
How many times have I tickled your ball sack with my tongue?
Wait,
can I break this down for you?
Okay, break it down.
Your ice cream was way the fuck better.
Way God, the fuck great. Better.
To the point I continued buying even
when
we didn't even have to buy it anymore.
No one
I was
has
still
to
buying.
Discuss that. No one in the world thinks
but
it's
quite
better.
Honestly, your personal story wasn't as impressive as his.
What's his personal story?
He got shot in the heart and lived.
We weren't competing on being in the wrong place when a bullet's being fired? And are you telling me it's the smarter person that gets shot through the fucking heart?
He actually has a real bullet shot at
him. Fuck yeah!
Oh,
no,
man.
See, the goal in life is the one who gets hurt the less wins.
That's true.
What the fuck is wrong with you people?
And
he was funnier than me, I suppose, on the fucking show.
No. But he had better stories.
Been shot at many times.
No,
that's true.
Fake shot.
No, but I have also been really shot at. I've really had a gun pulled on me me twice.
Oh, man.
And it was not fired, and I consider that to be because I handled the situation better.
Better than Trace
better.
Did.
Better. Yeah, I'll just give you a little piece of advice.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Getting shot worse than not getting shot.
I gotta agree with that.
So let's see. Trace is a better talker than me.
Yeah.
Smarter than me.
Oh, yeah.
Better ice cream than me. Yeah, you wouldn't believe it wasn't me, right? And I got really. Let me tell you this. In the Celebrity Apprentice world, you get sucked into that Scrooge McDuck fucking wacko shit. You get sucked into it and you believe it, right?
Yes.
So the final thing is coming down. I come on, do my buddies. They're really supportive. I'm feeling great, right?
That's great.
I go to do a show and wherever the fuck it was, New Jersey, right? And I'm feeling pretty good about myself.
Sure.
And I'm out signing autographs after the show. Like 1,000 people want to sign my autograph.
Nice.
And guy number five goes, man, O&A sold you out. And I go, what do you mean?
Where
they go, oh, they were saying that Trace should win. Trace was the winner.
Oh, my God.
He's never been on the show before. And they go, oh, they love him. They just sold you right to.
We're
and
easy.
So I go, okay, well, this guy's a nut, right? Because you get nuts.
Yes, sure,
right?
Of course you
get nuts.
Sign another 10, 15 autographs.
Uh-huh.
Whoa, did you hear O&A?
Oh, no.
What do you mean I hear O&A?
No,
oh, they sure love Trace, man. They
confirmed.
Were sucking his dick. Okay.
You bunch of fucking rats out there is what you are.
Okay. Let me just bring the whole thing. The whole thing
just
to an end.
Just a misunderstanding.
Yeah, yeah.
Take all the jokes out and everything.
Okay.
We finish signing about 1,000 people.
Yeah.
I'm standing there. We sign outside.
Yeah.
1,000 people have left. I'm standing there picking up my markers, picking up my water. Glenn comes over. Glenn goes, you okay? And I go, I'm a little bummed. It's stupid, but I'm a little bummed.
Oh,
he
no.
says, what? What? Why? Why? And I go, well, I heard that like O&A were saying that Trace should win. And he says, you know that this game doesn't mean anything to you. You don't give a fuck. I said, I don't give a fuck, but it just feels, like I've just gone through some sort of weird breakup. I'm really bummed.
Yeah.
And he says to me, well, you know, it's all the pressure of the show. You've been working hard. You haven't been sleeping. And I said, it was like five people. He said, I'm sure it's a misunderstanding. I'm going to call tomorrow. And the next day he says to me, yeah, I guess they did.
Oh, no.
Hold on. I do have two other points here. First of all, with the Trace Adkins, what impressed us, he gets shot in the heart by his wife or girlfriend at the time, and he doesn't scream. And he's just relaxed and goes, all right, call 911.
No, but that's in the story.
What? It was impressive.
But that's in the story. It's impressive.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean it happened that way.
Well, we're gullible. We believe half your tricks. They're not tricks. Sorry. But and here's the other thing about
there's swindles.
Here's the other
scams.
Thing about Celebrity Apprentice that blew me away for real. I saw the finale because I was rooting for you in the end. You know that.
Oh, I don't know that. Say that again.
We were rooting for you.
Okay, well, do you mean it?
I was hoping you won, but his goddamn story was like, oh, God. It's like he made it up to win.
It
had to be.
Precisely my point.
He had to make up for the fact that his ice cream was horrendous.
Horrendous.
It was horrible.
Was terrible.
But then this is what I learned by watching the finale, because you're on it. That's the only reason I watched.
Thank you.
And
your new boyfriend, Trace, was also on.
He is dreamy.
And the whole thing.
He is dreamy. He's better looking than me.
I would think
that if any two guys would not go for better looking,
it would
be you two.
You're right.
So, but here's my point. The whole season was a ruse.
Yes.
Because Donald Trump hated you from day one because of what you wrote in your book about him.
Oh, that's right. He called you out.
So he was never going to let you win anyway.
No.
Do people know this?
He said it on the air.
He said it on the air. Well, so I'm telling the people that maybe didn't watch the finale. He basically said that he doesn't like you because of what you wrote about him in your book.
That's what he said. And then he said, do you want to apologize? And I said, no.
Thank you. And thank
when
you for saying no.
When someone says to you, do you want to apologize, it's the moment of truth.
Right. That's the crossroad.
And I'm sitting there going, oh my, he had no intention of having you win ever.
No, there was no intention. And there was actually fights with Walgreens and the producers who wanted me to win.
Right.
And they were much more pissed than I was.
Yeah, because they could have sold a lot more ice cream if you won. Because in the end, it was a much better product.
And the other thing that I can't tell you who, but people involved in the production who were so embarrassed, ended up giving me that amount of money for the charity.
Wow, they did. Yeah.
Oh, good for you.
They just said, this was kind of bullshit. Let's write you. So Opportunity Village made a metric shit ton of money.
Well, I hope we straighten this all out, Pat.
And you came out to Vegas.
I came out to Vegas.
And you didn't wear your baseball hat.
No.
And you're absolutely unrecognizable.
He did not even recognize me.
And I knew he was there.
That's our biggest fear, though. When you guys finally give us an invite, we show up and like, he doesn't even know.
No, once I knew you, I greeted you with a great deal of joy.
You came back with great stories how you treated
him. It was fantastic, and the show itself is just amazing. I loved it.
I can't believe that your baseball hat is what I recognize.
I know. I didn't have the hat on, because, it's a classy jern. I want to be in a classy jern with a hat on. But what a great time, and the show was so much fun to watch, man.
Someone came to the show, and said, in Vegas, after the show, they said to me, you still hang out with Trace? And I said, well, he's playing golf with my wife right now. And he comes out, stays in the house, and plays golf all the time, and hangs out.
That's cool.
And then my family's going out to visit his family. We get along great. And we have no problem. There's no problems between me and Trace, except you two.
Yes.
I said, why the fuck did O&A suck up? I expected, I told you to put him on. Yeah, I told you he'd be good.
Yeah.
And I expected you to be cordial, polite, very, very complimentary. And then for one of you, I don't even care which fucking one. Either the WAP or the other one. Either one of you. Can't you either Opie, one of you would say, listen, man, you're really great, but Penn's been on the show forever. We got you to know that we're rooting for him. His ice cream is a little better. But listen, man, you are great. You are fabulous. Was that sentence ever said?
We did feel a little guilty.
No, it wasn't.
We felt a little guilty.
It wasn't said.
We felt a little guilty after the show. I think we might have a clip. Is it short, though? I don't want to waste Penn's time with a long clip.
Yeah, it's short.
All right, a short clip from that day.
Oh, no.
We hope you win Celebrity Apprentice.
I do, too.
you just told Penn that yesterday.
No, I don't even. I don't even know. No, I said it after we looked at his backstory that we have to go with this guy.
I did say that.
I changed my opinion, even though he's a really good friend of ours. But how do you not root for a guy like this?
Penn's a really good friend of mine, too, man.
Yeah, but Penn has a sex dungeon. That's all he's got going for him.
That's the Midwest. Wow.
What the most important part of that whole clip was, after Judas Iscariot over here kisses me on the fucking cheek. He then, three sentences later, says he is a friend of ours, and then this fuck beams in his chair and points to me like, see? After I said I wanted you to lose, I said you were my friend. See? I'm an okay guy. If you'd have sat there with your head down in shame like the fucking piece of shit you are, it would have been better. But it's the point in the smile.
That was really telling. You didn't have to interpret that clip much to see what he meant by it, which was,
I said we're a friend. He's a good friend of mine, too. Okay, and since when does New York back Louisiana over Massachusetts? Since when has that happened? In any sort of jingoistic, tribalistic thing, eyes are on my side.
But I never said your ice cream. I stuck to the point that your ice cream was better.
Thank you. Although friendship doesn't matter to you, gluttony does.
Penn, I don't want to throw Opie completely under the bus here,
but I have to
say something. Did you hear me in the background?
Yes, I did.
I said, Opie, oh my God, you were saying that to Penn, you phony load of shit.
Yeah.
What?
Yes,
he was there.
You sold me out.
I was backing Penn
the whole time.
I mean, practices. So, I love you guys and Opie Anthony. Oh, really? Yeah, I love one of them, man.
Oh, and then you have plausible deniability as to which one.
One of them is great, man. One of them is fucking great.
I swear I'm sweating. There's something a little real about this moment. I'm sweating.
I have to tell you, and this is the really embarrassing part.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm telling you something that is humiliating, and you know that I often don't kid. I just tell the truth when I tell it.
Yes.
I'm standing, we're playing like wherever it was, New Brunswick, New Jersey, right? Thousand people have got my autograph. Then I have to pick up my water bottle and my stuff. And I'm just standing like
And you're bummed. And he's bummed out.
after signing. You know, it's like, oh, I'm famous, I'm successful, I'm doing.
But
something's bothering me.
You'll leave here feeling a little better that I was only half the team. That's pretty good.
Good cop, bad cop.
Yeah, you know. I didn't feel good about Ant throwing me under the bus. Right?
No?
No. Uh-oh. I've been doing a little research on my own here.
Did you put E-Rock on an assignment?
Maybe. So, Penn, if you will, bear with me and just listen to this. Thank you.
Chase has lived the life here, man. The work ethic. The getting hurt on a real man's job.
Right.
The country music star. Weapons all charges. Jesus Christ. It's fantastic.
How are we going to tell Penn Jillette that we're not rooting for him anymore?
I know.
Should we call him?
I'm all in with Trace now. Yeah. And this is fantastic.
Yeah.
You asshole. Did I say that?
And I saw.
I can't have Penn leaving here today thinking you're a good guy and I'm not.
I saw Trace, you know, because I had my sad moment.
Yes.
Then the very next day I see Trace. Oh. And I didn't hear your fucking piece of shit show. So I'm in the green room with Trace. And I go, so I heard you had a good time with ONA. He said, yeah, thanks for getting me on that show. Ah. That was really great. And I go, I heard they kind of, he said, oh, your boys sold you out. He said, they are not your boys. Let me tell you that right now. Now, this Trace is a friend of mine. So yeah. Trace, a friend, is telling me, your boys, they just sold you out.
I don't remember saying that.
You can hear the tongue in cheek in there, right? You can, right? You can, right?
You've been trying that argument since you were 8, right?
You hear the tongue in cheek.
Has it ever worked?
No.
Has it ever? The I was just kidding, Mom.
I got to take an acting class.
No, he does that that Wounded Warrior commercial.
I know.
And you feel so good for him.
And he sings about the soldiers.
Oh my God.
It's not a dry eye in the house.
What a